You're talking to the Rolex wearing, diamond ring wearing, kiss stealing, woo, wheeling, dealing, limousine riding, jet flying, son of a gun, and I'm having a hard time holding these alligators down. Woo!
We'll do it live! Fuck it!
What's the prime time, bitch? What you gonna do?
Don't run away from your feelings!
You are so dumb. You are really dumb. For real.
I wanted to do hero stuff with my friend.
English, motherfucker! Do you speak it?
We'll do it live!
What
the fuck? English, motherfucker! Do you speak it? English, motherfucker! Do you speak it? English, motherfucker! Do you speak it?
Ladies and gentlemen, the FooL and Friends, episode 40-ish, possibly, it's got to be. We have at least two missing episodes. I know for sure. We have at least two missing episodes. Yes, definitely. But we are here.
Am I muted, by the way? No, okay. There we go.
Yeah, you're back.
You did it again?
I did it again.
He's fucking up.
Hey, what do you want me to do? There's a system in place.
Tell me no tonight.
Well, that's what happens when you change the cords around and shit.
No, we didn't change the cords around. We just moved the mics. That was all.
Oh, you flipped them?
Yeah, just he took that one that was there and moved it there and moved that one there. So I got to get used to it. I just got to switch it back after the show.
Or you could do that. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's it. But ladies and gentlemen, round of applause. Happy Thanksgiving for everybody tuning
Happy
in.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Thank y'all for tuning in this evening. We got some great movies on deck. We got The Birdcage.
Wide range of movies, really.
Wide range. The Siege on J. Dotville. And also Nightcrawler. And always the news in the beginning, the fun, topical, interesting shits. Bodega Pirate shall be with us shortly. He's running late as per usual on
JST. So
this JST.
Should be our chance to talk about our first impressions of season 7 of
Apex
before he gets in.
Well, we got a little bit prior, but now you've actually got to experience it. So, but yeah, and then Big Red, unfortunately, will not be with us at all this evening. He is with family. For Thanksgiving, you know, doing all that. So,
we miss you, Red.
We miss you. Shout out to you. But yeah, so, as Chuck just stated, Chuck hasn't really gotten to experience season 7 of Apex due to, you know, fatherhood. He's doing fatherly duties, but he has recently. So, Chuck, your take on it so far?
To be honest, at first I wasn't sure if I liked Olympus. Mm. It kind of gave me some weird Fortnite vibes, like the way it was, like the city escape kind of thing. But the more I play on it, the more I really like it.
Hmm.
It's just so much more open and bright, and it feels like it's definitely a sniper's map. Like, there's a lot of good positions to be in.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And the fact that it's a floating fucking city.
Right. Since I don't know the map as well as the World's Edge or King's Canyon, I always, like, look down, make sure I'm not going to jump off to my death, you know?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. There's been plenty of, like, oh, fuck
it. I actually did the other night, by the way.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, on accident.
Nice.
We won that game.
We still won.
We still won. I went sliding off, or, you know, sliding, I missed the staircase and went right over and just off and died. It's like, fuck.
Like, oh, well, this is how it's going. Fantastic. Yeah, no, I did that quite a few times, especially the first, like, week. Oh, yeah. There was plenty of, like, oh, shit, I'm being chased. I'm going to cut down here. I'll jump over that wall. Not knowing that jumping over that wall, there's nothing there.
Oh, there's been a few times when we were first playing, we'd jump up on a wall and look down like, oh, no. Don't go that way.
Mm-hmm. But, yeah, I like it.
I have not played with Horizon too much yet, but she seems pretty good. I just got to figure out how to use her properly, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, I think
kind of situations
from what I've seen, a lot is one for placement, you know, getting to spots, but also you're able to kind of post up and chill on the top of it, the gravity well, and just kind of
see. I should be doing that because I'm a triple tick user,
right? You know, as a sniper, that would work really well for you, actually.
Yeah.
But yeah, that and then the obvious the black hole that she throws.
That's pretty cool.
Which is pretty good because it just sucks everybody into that center. You can just throw some grenades in that
bitch.
It's
great. Like, wait till the storm closes in, suck that thing in, and throw Jibby's thing down. Yeah. Everybody's fucked.
Yeah, yeah. That or gas. Put some gas cans in there.
Or that. That's probably more likely to happen.
Facts. Big facts. But yeah, and then also they are bringing the train modes coming back, the Holiday Express.
Dude, we played the shit out of that last year.
That is coming, I think, next week, I believe, to celebrate Christmas. The Apex event, the Holiday Bash, Hollow Bash. They're bringing back the Holiday Express, the Winter Express, or whatever. I think it's Holiday Express. I think that's what it's called.
I think so.
But basically, it's a train. It's three cars, and it's a capture the point, and you have to hold at least one part of the train.
Kind of like King of the Hill.
Right.
Kind of.
Exactly. And it's fucking fun. You die, you respawn until whoever wins, unless it gets down to like sudden death where you all have to go to the middle car and at least be on it somehow, touching it.
It gets very chaotic very quickly.
Yeah, no, that mode is fun. And specifically because of you just die, you respawn, you go down, get back into the shit, you know? Yeah. So yeah, looking forward to that. Plus, obviously, the cosmetics and the sales and so on and so forth. So yeah, it's good stuff. Speaking of sales, Steam sales going on right now. To all my PC gamers, check out the Steam sale. A lot of good shit on sale right now. Things that if you're like, yeah, I wouldn't pay full price for it, but I buy it on sale. Well, check it out. Totally good. It's the autumn sale. I myself picked up Dragon Ball Z Kakarot. Came out in January this year. Solid game so far. Real fun if you're a fan of the series. So far, just did the Raditz part. To the T, mind you, which it was really fucking cool because, you fight him as Piccolo when he shows up, just like in the show. Then you fight him as Goku right before he steals your kid, like in the show.
You actually switch between characters in that one?
So far, yeah. So far, they've done it. Now, where I'm at, it's after, where Piccolo basically blasts Raditz and Goku in the chest, which, growing up with the show, I always remember that, like, yo, damn, like, as a, like... teen, like watching, I was like, yo, this show's fucking nuts. Like, he's got a hole in his chest. Like, wow. And that's the main character. Like, holy shit. That's how you beat a villain, right? So, like, the thing was, Raditz was Goku's brother, which was also really cool. They did all that. But now it's where Goku's basically going to be training in death. You get to play as Gohan, his son, and actually, like, he's out in the middle of nowhere, which I was thinking back, mind you, to all my Dragon Ball Z fans who watch the show. I think we all can agree that how is it that Piccolo's just like, yo, I'm taking your kid. I'm going to go train him in the wilderness. Not even going to be like, tell homeboy's mom, like, y'all figure that out. Piccolo was just like, there was no questions there. I'm taking your kid.
It's just red flag after red flag, and they're like, oh,
but the thing is, you come to find out as the series goes on, Piccolo is one of the dopest stepdads of all time. Because realistically, he became Gohan's second dad. Like, that's basically his role. And it's hilarious, because when you think about it, like, yeah, somebody of the other team, of the whole squad that was there, like, one of these people had to go tell his wife. Like, by the way.
As a non-Dragon Ball Z, or Dragon Ball fan, whatever, did Gohan agree to this?
Gohan's 5.
So basically,
he doesn't have consent.
So basically, this kid has Stockholm Syndrome.
Yeah, at this point, yeah. Okay. He's like Beauty and the Beast. If the Beast was a martial artist, doors locked. Can you go get a bodega pirate?
Sure.
But yeah, so, like, and the thing is, so, and they paint Chi-Chi, she's a hothead, like, that's why Goku and her hooked up, because she was a martial artist herself, and she kind of forced Goku to marry her. You know, typical anime, like, a funny thing, you know, because he's kind of, like, simple-headed, like, all he wants to do is fight and test his strength.
Right.
So, you know, it's just funny, because, basically, Piccolo's like, well, I'm just gonna take this kid, because he's gotta be strong as fuck. Because his dad's strong as fuck, and we train him now, and a year from now, when these motherfuckers show up to fight us, he'll be super strong. That was the logic there. It's great. As an anime, like...
I was going to say, that's like anime as fuck right there.
Like, this is hilarious. Because, again, nobody fought him on this. Nobody was like, well, hold on. One,
you're going to take my kid where?
You initially tried to kill Goku to begin with, like, because that was the other thing, too. Back in Dragon Ball, that was the end of Dragon Ball, was him fighting Piccolo and basically almost killing each other. You know? Yeah. And Piccolo still kind of doesn't like him at the beginning of Dragon Ball Z.
Yeah, I remember that, though. Like, they didn't really, like, agree.
Like, and then he was, like, early on, but he kind of obviously warms up to him real quick, which is understandable, whatever. But, nobody questions it.
That's pretty fucking creepy if you think about it.
Right? Like, I'm just taking the kid. Nobody asks a fucking question.
I don't want to fight you. I'm just taking your kid to the wilderness.
Right? I know I just killed your dad, but I'm taking you. Bye. And then he leaves him in the wilderness for 6 months by himself at 5 years old.
Are you my new dad?
You know? But, oh, honestly, though, so far, gameplay-wise, it's pretty fun. It's pretty simple. Dragon Ball Z Kakarot. I got it on sale during the Steam sale.
Nice.
And so it's so far going through from front to back. And real RPG, because you got to look everywhere. You got to plug it in here. You fly around. You actually fly around. There's random encounters. And when you fight, it's pretty simple mechanics. But fun. Like, you're like teleport dodging and shit. Like, it's Dragon Ball Z fight. It's good. So I'm looking forward to it. And finishing that out.
Well, let me ask you this then. As a non Dragon Ball fan,
Dragon Ball fan, you would enjoy it.
Just the gameplay in general.
Yeah, because it's fun. It's exciting gameplay. Like, because it's an RPG. But the fights remind me of kind of like how the Tales series grew. To be 3D combat. So just imagine a short burst of a Dragon Ball fight with not the heavy fighting game mechanics of like medium punches and kicks and shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, you have your dodge, your melee, and your blasts. You got those basic attacks, and then you hold down a button, and you can do super moves. Real simple shit, you know. Okay. And then you can call support because you got your homeboys are fighting with you. They're like, him and Piccolo were fighting together. It was pretty cool. Like, he's doing his own thing. Graphically beautiful. It looks really good. The voice acting is really good. And it's super RPG. Like, you have side quests, you know, explorable shit to do. And again, I've only put 2 hours into it so far. And I've been letting everything play out because I like to watch and hear it and see how it works. And it's just telling the story you know as a kid. Same story. So, like, it's nothing like, oh my god, but it's a love letter and it's good.
But it's nostalgic in a way.
Yeah,
to be,
super nostalgic.
To be a part of it, I guess.
And it's a good way to bring in, like yourself. Like, you're not a big fan, but if you were slightly interested, this would be the best way to do it. Because it gives you a lot and brings you into the world. And it also, with the side quest, you're exploring some of the past characters, like from original Dragon Ball and shit, which is pretty cool. So, I like it. It's on sale right now on Steam. I'm a fan so far. Also, on Xbox Game Pass, River City Girls.
Yeah.
Sleeper hit from last year. Didn't get enough attention, I think.
It didn't, no.
One, combat, glorious. One, I'm just going to say it. Kunio's girl, her name is Masako. She's
the blonde or the brunette?
No, the brunette. She's got like a buttercup type vibe to her.
She
from Powderpuff Girls.
She's about the scrapping. She's out running the
fame. So the original River City Ransom, you bought the books to learn how to fight better, right? And this one, you go to a dojo, you learn the moves, right? This chick, it sold me immediately with the combat, right? But then the moves, like, I was like, I don't know if I would recommend this to other people. Because it's super anime heavy, harder than the first one. Because one, it's an actual manga that like has voice acting. There's panels when it comes up. Then the intro sequences to each boss is a short little quick anime intro. And then they're talking and about the fight. Like, it's all pure anime. It's beautiful. It honestly is the people.
It's
who
a love
made
letter
it,
for yeah, River City Ransom.
Yeah, and the people who made it, you can tell they love the fuck out of doing this game. Because
it was a passion project.
Oh, God. There's so much heart in there. One, shout out to the people who was like, yo, let's put the Terminator in there. Because there's a mob, a normal enemy that comes out the side, a scream or whatever, like you beat up anybody else, but he's the fucking Terminator. And when you hit him, you hear, wow. Kids, you fucking not. It's fact. Beautiful.
It's fact.
And then my favorite thing of all, though, this chick, one of her super moves, per se, or like special moves, when you grab him, you hit the button, she kicks him in his shit, and she fucking stuns him.
My God. Yo, it's a Stone Cold Stunner.
Every time it feels so good. Every time. And then she also has this lunge punch that just when you connect every time, you're knocking these dudes too. Like, it's satisfying. The combat, and she has a power bomb. So, like, I would kick a guy into the air, jump up, and power bomb his ass.
Nice.
It feels great. But then, after you beat the game, there's two endings so far. I might play through it again to see if there's a third ending. But there's two endings. And after you beat it, you unlock Ricky and Cooney. And I was like, oh, well, they'll probably just be like, you know, copy and paste movesets, right? No. They're actually different. Like, Ricky, the dude who wore the blue, mm-hmm. the darker color guy, the suit, him, he has a move where he throws his comb and nice. Hits him and teleports to him and does his silly-ass combo. I was like, this is fucking amazing. Like, wow. Why haven't I played this? And I'm sad that it's a whole year later after the fact that I'm like, I'm finally playing this shit. It's really good. My only complaint, though, is as much as I love the anime aspect of it, the constant girl band singing every other, like, few levels was kind of getting me. Like, at first I was like, oh, okay, cool, whatever, I can vibe with this. But then it's like they go through, like, five songs. Like, it was like a little short EP or LP. I don't know what you would call it. EP? Yeah, it's like a little 4 or 5 album. Like,
because an LP is a long play.
EP's extended play.
Okay, so there we go. Thank you. But yeah, that's... And now, don't get me wrong, the girls can sing. Like, they have... It's good music. It's just... I'm not trying to hear that shit while I'm beating the shit out of these... Everything from cheerleaders to fucking...
Teachers,
police-looking nice. Guys, preppy boys, fucking mafia dudes.
See, I still want to play that because I love River City Ransom.
It's worth
it. For it to go on a really good sale.
No, it's definitely worth it for sure. Mm-hmm. Do not sleep on that one.
So yeah, that is another good one. I just finished Katana Zero. Quick side scroller, real quick, kind of like Super Meat Boy, where you keep dying a lot until you kind of figure out the best way to do the level. And it's a really good game.
I like those.
Super cool story. Very visual. 80s, it's got a like videotape type vibe to it. It's really dope. Cool, simple, another good one on the Game Pass. Which one are you referring to, Scotty? So far right now I mentioned River City Girls and Katana Zero.
What's up, Scotty?
But these are on Game Pass. So $10 a month if you have Xbox One or if you have PC. It's available on both platforms.
Right on.
And it's totally worth $10 in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's a Need for Speed that just got uploaded recently. I'm not sure which one.
Hot Pursuit. It's a remaster of the 2010 version.
You see, to me, I'm still fucking with Forza 4, dude. There's so much in that game. There is so much on that game that is so rich.
And Horizon, too.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Forza Horizon 4, dude.
That's
that game, to me, it is the epitome of... It's the perfect balance to me, and we've talked about these games before.
Yeah, yeah.
But to me, it's just that I keep playing it more and more, and the open world of it, the fact that you can race, like almost as good as Gran Turismo, you know.
Right.
And to me, the biggest factor in Forza 4 was the seasonal change.
Mm.
So every few weeks, you'll rotate based off your XP because it does have an RPG level to it, a sense to it, where if you get enough experience points, you shift over seasons. So, you know, you say that you buy a Miata and you have it for the spring or whatever. In the winter, you might want to get winter tires for it and you could actually rally race with this bitch.
Yeah.
And it's amazing, dude. It is fucking... That to me, so far, that's what I've been on. That's been my latest kick so far. I haven't gotten Miles Morales. You've played it before. I know that you've been ranting and raving.
I was actually going to touch on that next.
You've been ranting and raving on it, but I'm not getting it until the Game of the Year edition comes out. Because if it's as great as you're saying it, dude, there will be a Game of the Year edition around. And I'm not going to get fucked on that again.
Yeah, no, I don't blame you. I don't blame you at all. I don't blame you one bit with that, honestly. I needed.
Oh no! I've been trying to like just. I keep watching fucking Into the Spider-Verse just to hold me over in the meantime.
Bro. And running around the city in that outfit, bro.
Yes. Yes.
So good.
Dude, now, can we also talk, and I posted it on the page. Mm. Can we talk about the song that Jaden did, dude? That was...
No, shout out to him.
Yes, dude. That song's dude, that's a fucking banger. Not only that, but then It's Our Time, and I forgot the other artist, but It's Our Time still fucking slaps too, dude. Yeah. And again, that's where I was going with this. It's... That this line between video games and movies, it's starting to blur.
Bro, when I tell you, like, so I picked it up. Yeah. I was like, fuck it. I'm a...
When I told you that it was on PS4.
Thank you again. No, and the thing is, it's funny because, again, real quick, back to that point from last time we talked about it. I saw another article, another fucking advertisement. Hashtag Spider-Man, hashtag PS5, hashtag Sony Network.
Yeah.
No PS4.
Yeah.
Even the picture they used, no PS4.
Yeah,
this is a dick move, honestly.
And I was just like, yo, they really are trying to get people like
to move up.
It is on PS4.
PSA.
You don't need to buy a PlayStation
PS4.
5, and it looks just as good.
Miles Morales PS4.
Yes.
Right? That's what.
Well, and dude, and all right, so let's go back because now there are more problems coming to rise with now the Xbox One or the Xbox X or whatever the fuck they're calling it and the PS5.
Xbox S.
So now, evidently, I think if it's a certain game, it bricks.
Yes.
It bricks the entire fucking
system. One of the articles, actually.
Yeah.
And we've talked about this before,
yeah, and then,
too.
And
this
then,
is why we don't buy first generation.
Exactly. And look, to any of our listeners out there, this is something that it's going to be our hill to die on. Forget about the fucking Flex. Forget about the fucking, you know, like, spend your money somewhere else. Like, wait until these generations get their shit worked out.
Yeah.
You don't, like... Dude, evidently, so they figured out what the problem is with the PS5, that if you overstore it, it can't cool, and then it bricks itself, too.
Yeah.
So these are fucking ridiculous problems. Like, look,
guys.
It's
the same problem the 360 had, is it would overheat
exactly.
And burn the stupid X-clamp.
So to me, here's the whole thing. Like, okay, Sony, maybe Xbox, no, because, okay, they've only been in the game for 19 years. Okay, I'll give them that. But
only.
Sony, Sony's been on this shit for a quarter of a century now.
Mm-hmm.
Delay the fucking thing, man. Like, delay it and fucking give us a better product. I'm okay with that. Like,
well,
Cyberpunk got delayed again, and there's gonna be death threats and everything. And fuck all of y'all that did this
shit.
Don't
give death threats to fucking.
At a certain point,
they're going to make a better product.
The
That's
shareholders push the shit. I mean, there's nothing they can only do so much.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's ridiculous because they push something to get these sales, and when it's like, hey, I would be like, look, just buy the fucking game. Because really, the console sales, yeah, they make their money, but realistically, the games are where they make the bulk
obviously,
of their money.
Obviously, without a doubt. Yeah,
that's just, we know this. So
that's one of the reasons that Sony's advertising Miles Morales as a PS5 game, not as a PS4 and a PS5 game.
When I tell you, I was so glad to pick it up. When I play this shit, the way they start is they give you the option to recap.
Yeah.
Now, this guy here, he didn't play the original Spider-Man one that came out prior.
Okay.
So he had thought it was just like, oh, some offshoot shit. I'm like, no. It's a branch off of the same story.
It's basically a sequel, if you will.
Yeah,
Shout out to Scotty for letting me borrow the first one.
Right, shout out to Scotty. Yes. You did him a great... That's what friends are for.
Last year.
So by now, if you haven't played the first one, you know now, obviously, Miles is in it. Mm-hmm.
He gets bit.
In this particular universe, they use his father as the catalyst.
Yeah.
His, lost person, basically, and his father gets killed in a. It was the.
It was recognition. It was a medal ceremony for
his
father.
Right, and then the negative guys showed up, and that scene was dope as fuck. Mm-hmm. But you got to play as Miles a little bit, which I was right then and I was like, oh shit, this is gonna be something that happens in the future.
Oh, they fed into that. It was lovely.
So back to the recap, you hit that, you get to see all that.
Wow.
And then they basically, boom, shut you right, throw right into the... You and Peter are taking on Rhino as the game starts.
Nice!
Which
yes.
is amazing.
Yes!
And it's the same voice actor. The only thing I don't like is they went back and they did his face to look more like fucking Holland.
Yeah? Okay. And
it's
then,
weird.
Shout out... Okay,
it's so weird,
and I don't
dude.
Know if I mentioned this in the last episode, but shout out to the one black developer... And that team. You know why? Because if you look at a side-by-side from Miles from that first Spider-Man till now, oh no, my man's is fresh. He got the clean hairline and everything. And I could just imagine how that went down at the developers meeting.
Right?
He's like, okay, so if anybody has a question, and then that one black dev, he's like, yo, I got something to say. He's like, what? He's like, y'all can't have Miles out here like this. He's like, what do you mean? He's like, He's Spider-Man. He could have that hair like that. No. He will get fucking dragged and roasted. Yo, bro. My man. Yo, what the fuck is up with your the fucking fade? Get the fuck out of here.
And okay. Clean.
And then they're like, no. Miles has to have a clean fucking fade.
And as authentic as it gets, you get one of his original costume. Mm. His homemade Spider-Man costume. He rocks fucking Tim's in the like pants.
But they ruined it by taking away the J's.
Hey, fuck you. Fuck you, man. That's
them Adidas are fire.
Fuck out of here.
He had J's.
Fuck out of
here.
Hey,
I like the J's. The J's were nice.
Tim's, no. Dude.
But the Adidas?
Tim's, dude. If you're going to stomp out a motherfucker.
What?
If you're going to stomp out the Rhino
New York shit.
Yeah, exactly. If you're going to stomp out the Rhino dude, you need Tim's, all right? Fuck out of here.
When I tell you, I saw that, I was like, yo, that right there.
You're.
I was like, that's legit. But honestly, no. Seriously, though.
Dude, no. Even further. Sorry. One more. And I got to drill down on this more. So the Bodega Cat. Bodega Cats are a thing in New York. They are, dude.
Bro.
And
Spider-Man.
Spider-Man.
I was going to actually go. I was going to mention that. See, what I love the most about it, my first half hour playing it, the intro, everything. But then he's chilling at home at Christmas with his moms. His mom's in the kitchen cooking. And you hear her on the phone and she's talking Spanish. It just feels good. For once.
New York experience,
he
baby.
He was Dominican. Why they change him to Puerto Rican?
Hey, man, that's all right.
Look, we getting representation for once. Yes. I'm happy about it.
Afro-Latinos made it, bro.
Bro.
That's what it is.
Hey, I love Adidas.
Shut the fuck up.
I'm just saying.
Shut the fuck up.
I'm just saying.
Don't do that.
I love Adidas. I'm cool.
You're a Browns
this.
Fan, dude. That's what I'm always going to keep using for anything you complain, dude.
7-3.
I know, bro. And we're still going to make the playoffs before you will,
we're
bitch.
We're going to be 8-3.
And y'all ain't going to make the playoffs. The Giants are going to make a playoffs with a fucking 6-11 season. Bet that. Bet that, bro.
The Browns are going to be like 11-5.
And y'all ain't
and they'll miss
shit.
Out because they play with Baltimore. And Pittsburgh in the same division.
Fucking ridiculous.
Let's go, Giants.
So, it's super authentic. It really, you know, it hits home.
It's not. It's not that authentic because Miles doesn't get a Brooklyn mission. And
don't wear Adidas!
And doesn't get a Queens mission. So, it's authentic to a certain degree. But until I see Miles get Brooklyn missions and Peter get Queens missions.
But tell me, though. The video I sent in the chat with the little block party.
Oh, dude.
And
no,
the people was dancing.
There, it's there, dude.
Like,
it is.
I was sitting there with Pops.
Yeah, you were walking through the block party?
Yo, Pops was sitting there watching. He's like, God damn.
It's
like,
authentic.
They got some moves.
Yeah.
I was like, yeah. I was like, they easily mocap like some professionals, like, do this.
Salsa dancers and shit do this on there.
And it's cool because when I did it that night, I stopped. I was like, you know, I'm going to wait here. I'm going to play this tomorrow.
Yeah.
And I loaded it. It was different people.
Yeah.
They were still doing the same dances, but it was different, like, characters.
Yeah.
Which I was like, that's pretty fucking cool. So, yeah, that's worth it. If you was like, damn, should I do this for myself? You should.
Do it.
You should.
I'm not going to do it, but everybody knows my reasons why.
Right. And he got burned, and that's fine. But, hey, I'm telling you, look, and I feel like it might lead up to the DC clone where you get to play as him at the same time as, like, two players.
Because
they're doing that. DC's doing that.
Yeah.
Arkham style.
Yeah.
Where you can play multiplayer.
It might happen, dude.
So
it might happen.
That would be
how
amazing.
Bro, how sick would that be? And then they can, like, introduce fucking Spider-Gwen.
Oh, my God. Dude, but then down the line, what they're saying is that they might bring Scarlet Spider in.
That's cool.
And, dude, I'm okay with Scarlet Spider.
Like, I mean, honestly, at this point, I could see a Spider-Verse on that
shit,
too.
I mean, they're building that up, dude, for sure.
Oh, God.
And on that note, all right, so do you want to talk about some of the casting rumors for Spider-Man 3 or no?
Oh, yes.
Dude.
Yes.
They are
hold up. The most recent one, though.
Alfred Molina.
Yes!
Alfred Molina, yeah.
Yes!
Two, though.
Yeah.
Doc Ock. They're bringing him back?
It's rumored. It's rumored, dude. But, like, this could be Sony's Avengers, and this could be Phase 4's Civil War.
Oh, yeah. Bro.
Like, just because of the talent and,
well,
like,
I think
all the
what's
shit
gonna
that they're
happen
bringing
is,
in.
Because a lot of this is going to be going down in Multiverse of Madness.
Mm-hmm.
The Multiverse of Madness, as I have stated before on multiple shows, is going to be the thing that ties in everything.
That's your bet, yeah. To
Easily.
To me, like
because
I said,
Deadpool 3 has been greenlit. That's another thing we're going to talk
about.
Yes,
we are. And let's talk about the fucking writer.
Hold up before. Alfred Molina, again, is It's pretty much going to happen.
He's greedy.
Jamie Foxx is definitely already on board.
He's confirmed, but it's rumored with Alfred Molina. We don't know with Molina.
But if you have Jamie Foxx confirmed, Maguire is pretty much, he's in talks, so that's going to be confirmed. You know, I'm telling you,
A lot of things can happen between talks and confirmation, dude. Bro. Like, don't set up, don't.
With
don't
Daredevil talk. Getting the rights back tomorrow, I'm telling you right now, this, dude, I would love that one. We have to all see. Fucking the madness. We have
to. Oh, we have
they need to.
To
bring back Ghost Rider, but do it right.
Dude, yes. They get the guy from
and
Agents
Danny,
of S.H.I.E.L.D.
If you're watching, no. Danny, Nick Cage was not a good Ghost Rider.
Dude.
He does that shit
Agents
to get me.
Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Agents yeah. of
no,
S.H.I.E.L.D.
No.
I'm telling you right now, I think it's like season 5.
Yeah,
Agents
they
of S.H.I.E.L.D.
introduced, and that guy was a bad motherfucker.
Fuck. Bro, when I was like, they introduced him, I was like, ooh, are they really doing Ghost Rider? And then I saw it, and I was like, oh, they did Ghost Rider.
They did.
Oh, and it was good.
It's a shame because Nicolas Cage ruined it, and now no one will fucking touch it.
But the thing is that
so that was one of Marvel's little forays into what they were going to call Marvel Knights, and that was when they were going to go with their darker R-rated content, and that took a huge shit.
It shit itself.
Yeah.
And now, though, they've seen what they can do with it.
Yeah.
With Robbie Reyes, bro?
Well, the thing is, I think, forever, retrospectively, we are going to look back at Deadpool as the trailblazer in this one, as the pioneer. Because he was the one that, like, Marvel went and took a risk. Well, X-Men.
For Marvel.
Fox Marvel. Not
we'll say for
Disney.
Marvel, because there was other R-rated superheroes that were like, holy shit.
Yeah, Blade. But Blade, yeah, but even Blade was a United Artist, or I don't...
That's what I'm saying, specifically
like
for Marvel.
Yeah.
For Marvel, yeah, Deadpool was
well,
their...
That was
like,
Fox Marvel. That was back when, like, this was already, when universes were already being built, you know? And fucking Deadpool knocked it out of the fucking park. And then all of a sudden, then fucking Logan...
Jesus.
Because now here's the whole thing.
A great fucking
here's
movie.
Here's the whole thing. I think that Hugh Jackman always wanted to do an R-rated Wolverine.
Oh,
it's just that the studios wouldn't let him until fucking Ryan Reynolds opened that door for him, and then they're like, "Look, this is what we can do." And then, dude, didn't Logan get a fucking best adapted screenplay Oscar or some shit like that?
Definitely got some nominations.
It won an Oscar.
But to make a Wolverine movie like that, especially Old Man Logan,
dude,
has to be rated R.
Well, no, dude, to me, like, I was not on board with when they were saying, oh, we're going to borrow from Old Man Logan. Because if you actually read Old Man Logan, and do yourselves a favor if you haven't read it.
Such a good
dude, movie. It is such a powerful and moving... Quick spoiler alert. So what it is that Mysterio actually tricks Wolverine into killing the X-Men. And then that broke his heart. That, like, shattered him. To the point where, like, he never unsheathed his claws again and everything like that. He drops and fucking falls into a railroad track trying to kill himself. The train derails. That's one of those powerful scenes in there. But again, this is, like, it involves the Avengers and everything. And I read through all this and I was like, there's no fucking way that they're going to do this. And they did it, dude. They did it, and it fucking worked.
But
well.
Who did they replace Mysterio with? Was it Professor that they just ultimately replaced it with?
No, Mysterio was replaced by...
That's the one thing I'm
forgetting
right now.
I think it was a hybridization because they replaced... They replaced the Mysterio
thing.
Because
it still happened.
Yeah, well, the thing was is that in the comic book, what it was is that it was the rise of the villains.
Right.
So it was like... oh, my God, I forgot his name. Orson... Harry...
Osborn,
thank you. Yeah. So it was Harry Osborn, Apocalypse, fucking Baron Zemo, they all teamed up, and they, like, it was like a calculated strike on the Avengers, on the X-Men and everything.
Shout out to Zemo, he's coming back. That's
but great. What it was is that in this case, it was just that Professor Xavier, because of the weight of his mind, he flipped out and killed all these other superheroes.
Right.
So that was like that was one of those twists that they're like, okay, this is how we're going to do it. But the Mutant Hunters, yeah, that was definitely Old Man Logan for sure.
Yeah.
You know? And the fact that they brought X-23, oh my God, like...
Yo, that girl.
Daphne Keane, dude,
I hope that if they do, like, a continuation, like, they bring, like, X-Men in, she gets to come. I hope they
somehow tie the universes together, and it'll be, like, an adult Laura.
Yeah.
It won't be,
she'll still be the same actress.
No, without a doubt. If she knows how to act, dude, and that's the whole thing for sure.
I think they would be... It would do good on them, too. If they're, because here's the thing, what Marvel's doing right now, I can even admit that they're doing super PC right now.
Yeah,
I get it. I understand you want to make the next chunk of shit, different. Got it. If you want to do that and you want a Wolverine, you got her. Right.
But the
there.
Thing is that I think now when they bought the rights, and because some of these artists still have control over what they say and can do, they're willing to take a few more risks because the risks have already paid off the dividends.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know, like, you know, and of course they were all through Fox because it was Deadpool and Logan. But now they're ready to do this, you know?
Yeah.
And are we still moving on to Deadpool, or are we still talking?
Well, actually, real quick on the Spider-Man front, though, there was the other thing that they've already kind of hinted at unintentionally. And I don't know. I mean, it's a long shot, but there was the article I linked where it was a costume. And we all know the toys and the costumes are pretty much precursors to these days.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well, the thing that's standing out is the Venom costume. The Venom costume in the Venom movie with Tom Hardy.
The black symbiote? Tom Hardy. Yes.
The Tom Hardy movie, his Venom, we all remember, did not have the spider.
Yeah.
This costume that has been leaked has the spider on it now.
So now Spider-Man is going to get a black symbiote.
But what they're thinking, and what I think, it's a good possibility at this point, depending on when Venom 2 drops and when Madness drops, is they meet somehow.
Yeah.
And Spider-Man gets the symbiote for the movie for either Multiverse of Madness or whatever. He gets it, and then it goes back initially.
I mean,
to
for
Tom
all we
Hardy.
Know, for all we know, understand that the Infinity War or the Endgame for Phase 4 can be the Secret Wars.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
That's very possible.
That, well, yeah, but Secret Wars. Still, I think this is probably the best route to go.
This is still like a few years down the road, but it's still
That's oh no. I feel like that's probably their next end game is Secret Wars.
Yeah,
that's going to be their next big culmination because you'll have by that time the X-Men, the Fantastic Four, the fucking
Avengers,
the everybody, Defenders, fucking the new Avengers.
So are we ready to talk about Deadpool's writers or no? Because I'm excited about that,
dude. Deadpool 3.
Who are the writers? Does anybody here know who the writers for
Deadpool? I know.
You want to let them know? You want to break
fucking
them up?
Bob's Burgers.
Yes.
What?
Yeah.
Wait, who in particular? Lauren Bouchard?
Both of them. The Bouchard sisters are going to write Deadpool 3 as an R-rated feature. I am there for that fucking rain.
That's fucking amazing.
That I'm there for that fucking train.
And it's Ryan Reynolds and them. Yes. All of them together. Ryan's and them are writing it together.
Oh, yeah.
So it's not just them. It's him, too. So you know he's going to be like, look, I trust you guys. Just follow this for me.
Just follow this little weird path I'm in. And then they're like, yeah, we're going to go down that path. And the thing is, dude, is that, like, so it's funny because I follow, I think, Bob's Burgers on Instagram. Mm. And then when they announced it, they had Bob dressed in a Deadpool suit.
Nice. That's fucking nice.
So they're like, so we did a thing. And but no, here's the whole thing. So shout out because it's going to be women writing a R-rated action superhero comic.
Not even just women. Fantastic women.
Yes.
Because everything they touch is amazing.
Dude, and that's the whole thing. Like, you, dude.
And that's the thing. I myself, as somebody who hasn't gotten into, like, Bob's Burgers.
Oh, no, dude. Bob's Burgers is...
It's like, I watched a couple of episodes, and I'm like, two or three I've seen, I'm like, yo, this shit actually...
It took me a while. It took me a while to get into Bob's Burgers, and the only reason I got into it is because of, L. John or B. John Benjamin? Or
H. John Benjamin.
H. John Benjamin. And it's because he voiced Archer.
Right.
Yeah.
And then I was like, all right, so
that
I need a
crossover episode by
Did you guys watch Home Movies, though?
Yes.
Oh, yes. Okay, yes. Of course. Yes, he was the coach.
Yeah.
Yeah, Coach McGurk.
No, not only that, but he makes a cameo in an episode of Bob's Burgers. This is how deep I am into Bob's Burgers now. And it's where Louise is forced to play a soccer game, and then she's at a porta potty, and then, dude, there's the coach from fucking
Home
Movies.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, dude. Awesome.
No, but I love that was the one. That was one of the one episodes I did catch was the crossover episode.
Yeah,
that shit, like the way he talked to himself, bro. God damn, that was the writing. Yeah, I'm excited for Deadpool 3 now. Like, because it's crazy. Because I think it was like 2 or 3 weeks prior, Ryan Reynolds was like, "Y'all need to get this shit together."
See, Ryan Reynolds is the smartass, and then to have such good puns lined up for him.
Oh, dude,
it's gonna be awesome.
It's gonna be fucking homer after homer after home run,
bro. I mean, honestly, because I think there was also talks I think Matt had mentioned it at some point too in one of our previous shows that he should have took over for Stan Lee in regards to like cameos and everything because it would just kind of make sense.
Yeah,
but apparently he didn't want to do that.
Dude, those are some big shoes to fill.
Respectful, though.
Yeah. Right, and I get it. But now seeing this, I'm like, damn, dude. can you please do it? Because, God, like, imagine. He's not. I mean, with the writing power he can keep bringing to the table.
I think what it was is that he might be doing it for, like, the current phase, but then after that he'll, like, step away, you know? Like, he'll just bounce around from, like, fucking movie to movie to movie.
Yeah, I don't, man, it's just exciting.
All right, so what's next on the docket?
It's super exciting. I'm excited.
What question, next, though? God. Is Cable coming back?
Oh, he has. Like,
I don't know.
I
don't know the premise. Have they not released anything?
No, they haven't. I think what's-his-name said he wasn't too fond of coming back to doing Cable.
Josh Brolin?
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, that could have been one of those hearsay things, but...
What's next on the docket?
One thing that really was surprising this week was Dave Chappelle.
Okay, that was it. Yeah, I'll go with that one.
This guy, shout out to him. I love and respect this man.
Get your fucking bag right, bro.
Are like, yo, take my shit down.
But it wasn't even Netflix's fault. It was Viacom's fault.
And the thing is, what I love most about the situation is that Netflix, one, shout out to them for respecting his wishes. I need another drink. Somebody can get me a drink out the...
Serge.
Hey, Serge, can you get me a...
Appreciate it.
But shout out to Netflix on that. I know Netflix is kind of looked at sometimes and like...
For canceling great fucking...
You know, they get good light, bad light.
Yeah.
It's a 50-50 with them. It is. Like... I support it because I support a lot of the good content they do get.
Yeah.
Granted, they fuck up, and thank you. Cancel out shit they shouldn't cancel. They should have fucking picked up Into the Badlands and gave them another season.
Yes.
God damn it, that show was amazing.
They should have kept going with Altered Carbon. That's just my hill to die on.
The Magicians, they should have picked that shit up,
Which
too.
One?
The Magicians, they should have gave them another. Love that show.
Fuck sci-fi, dude, for canceling the Magicians. And I'm glad that Amazon finally picked up The Expanse. The Expanse is so
cool. Hopefully they'll pick that up, because I would love to see that show.
I mean, it's what?
Again.
What, another The Magicians?
Iteration. Yeah, another iteration or something.
Maybe a reboot, but not.
Because that was my one, like I called that a CW show.
Yeah.
That was, like, my one CW show I was backing. Because it had the CW vibe, but it was just enough off the side where it was, like, just some fucked up shit. And it's pretty cool. It's like Harry Potter, like, on meth.
All right. That gives maybe you the floor, meth. Man.
Like, Harry Potter on coke. Like, if Harry Potter went to American college...
Okay, so Molly and Coke.
Yeah, there you go. Molly and Coke. But no, honestly, it's a really fun show. Check it out sometime. But yeah, no, shout out to Netflix for, like, you know what, we respect your wishes, because he's not making money off of it because of the fucking bullshit deals between Viacom
and all Dave that. Chappelle, yeah.
Yeah, and, like, I respect his decision wholeheartedly. And I'm glad I didn't watch it, because I was thinking about it, because I was like, I'm going to finish up The Office, and I got to put something next up.
Yeah.
Dave Spell's there. I might do that.
Nah.
And then it's gone. And I was like, I was thinking about that. But yeah, so.
Fuck Viacom for screwing over Dave Chappelle and Key and Peele.
Yes. Oh. Yo.
They fucked them hard.
Even though Key and Peele kind of like filled that Dave Chappelle gap. I don't know. That was kind of some shit.
That show was hilarious.
It is.
It was.
But we all can agree that was like, well, we can't have Dave Chappelle, so we'll get Key and Peele.
But that's the whole thing. Yeah. Like, and Viacom still fucked them the same way. That's the other thing. You know, and shout out to them because they are fucking blowing up as well. So,
both of them,
Both have really good
real.
Careers.
Both, yeah, exactly. Both of them have amazing careers. Like, I'm happy for.
All right, what else we got?
I'm excited as fuck because my boy Robert Englund is coming to season four.
Yes,
Yo, I swear to God, if there's not at least one stuffing. Nightmare Elm Street reference.
Or if you call someone bitch at least once.
Oh, God.
Yes. Dude, he's got to.
The sad thing is that fucking Michael J. Fox just retired from acting.
Mm-hmm.
But dude, the Parkinson's, evidently it's gotten way too bad and everything. But it would have been, dude, that would have been the icing on the cherry on the fucking cake.
Bro.
Let's get Robert Englund and let's throw Michael J. Fox in there again, dude. Right there, dude.
The thing is, there hasn't been much obviously said about what he is going to be playing or, you know, what his role is.
But, dude, obviously the Soviets will get involved again.
Yo. I'm excited, though. The show, honestly, that's another one that Netflix, they fucking hit it out the park with that one, boy.
But they can't milk it for too long, though.
No.
The brothers
said that I think they maybe got one or two more seasons, yeah. And that's
like,
it.
One
okay,
more.
Good, because the kids will get too big too fast. Mm-hmm. The story's going
to
get dragged
But you
on,
see, I mean, it, to me, it would have been lovely to see because, like, for example, I know that Finn's probably going to end up being like a fucking, like a government agent or some shit like that, like in The Paranormal or some shit
right.
like that.
I can see
know.
That.
You know, he's going to marry fucking Eleven and they're going to fucking, and he's going to, like, in order to keep her away from all that shit, he's going to, like, fucking be a government agent like
that. But then we also, again, and I don't know, hopefully this season they're going to do it or maybe the next, but goddamn it, there's 10 other fucking numbers before
she met,
her.
She met
one of them.
Yeah.
See, what they should do is have Finn as an adult and do an X-Files Stranger Things crossover.
Oh, yo. That'd be fucking awesome. Season 5. I'm calling it right now. Season 5. Yo. They're going to bring up. They're gonna
one
bring
of
back,
those two.
No, they're bringing them both. That's my bet, dude.
That would be
who's
hilarious.
Taking that action? Who's taking
I can't
that action?
Take the action?
Who's taking the action?
I take one of those two actors.
Who's
actresses.
Taking the, no, I'll take both, dude. They're bringing fucking.
I will join you on the characters per se or the actors and actresses character wise. I don't know.
It depends no, they're on not what, bringing David Mulder
it,
and, or
depends on
Fox
what role
or whatever.
Robert Englund plays. If he plays some kind of like a mad scientist,
they are bringing back David Duchovny and Gillian Anderson as investigative agents. Agents. That is my fucking bet.
That would be hilarious, though.
Season 5, baby. Call it right now. Lock it in.
That would be a dope crossover, actually.
Not even a crossover.
It could work. It totally could
work. Yeah, because they were FBI paranormal investigative agents.
Yeah. I mean, but also, I mean, look what they did with Sean Astin. Like, when they brought him in last season.
Shout out to him, dude. He had a good arc.
Or no, previously. I'm sorry. Season 2.
Yeah, season 2.
And, like, they didn't waste him, you know? And you were rooting for him the whole time. They like I don't know what it is.
Rudy.
No, Rudy. At the end of that shit, I was like, God damn it, no.
Oh no, come on, man. Everybody knew it was coming, dude.
Exactly.
Everybody.
I didn't want it to happen though.
No,
nobody did, but I was like,
you can't help but love his character.
No, Rudy.
And
no.
I was gonna say,
I went in Latino. I was like, no.
That
Rudy,
must
no.
be like either like his role for his agent or something, because God damn it, every role he gets. You root so hard, fucking so hard for that motherfucker. When he was Sam, like he had that weird little gay love thing going with Frodo.
Oh no, he was dick riding Frodo, dude.
Bro,
he was,
that bromance was like right about to teeter over to legit romance.
Wait, is Greater Joe watching? Because it's only gay if the balls touch.
Throwback to the garage. But yeah, like every role he has, you do not. Fucking Goonies.
I was going to say Goonies, yeah.
You know, you always are rooting
for
this man.
Thank God that they haven't rebooted the Goonies, man.
Just leave it alone. Nah. For fuck's sake, leave it alone.
Yeah, they are, dude.
If worst comes to worst, I swear to God, if it's just not the parents sending their kids on an adventure, then they're fucking
up. No. It's going to be, you know what it is? It's going to be a young, scrappy group of kids against gentrifiers. Bet that.
It's going to be PC as fuck, and it's going to be terrible.
Against gentrifiers, dude. It's going to be like something that's sold.
The only way, again, they're getting that by is if everybody comes back and it's their kids. Mm-mm. That's the only way they're getting it by. That's it.
That's the only way I'll actually give a shit about
no,
it.
No, exactly. They're not, dude, because even Short Round, or no, not Short Round, I forgot his name, but the same actor that played
Theta.
Short Round, Theta, okay.
Theta.
He's like a fucking doctor now or some shit like that, dude, so.
Kim Jong is a doctor. The comedian.
Kim Jong. Yeah, no, but he's like, he said, no, I'm happy where I'm at, blah, blah, blah. Maybe we could get him out, but, I mean,
honestly, if they, let's be real, money talks. Mm-hmm. If they offer each of them enough money, they.
No, but shout out to Rudy, dude, because he made out with his sister, with his brother's girlfriend.
Bro, he made out with Thanos' chick.
Yes, dude. That's big dick player right there, dude. Big dick player.
Love it.
So, yeah, she's like, wait, she's like, I didn't, right? She's like, wear your braces, and then the other girl's like, girl.
No, and even her friend, the dorky one, she has a career still. Like, good.
Does she?
Yeah.
Because Elizabeth Shue was Thanos' girlfriend.
Oh, what's her face?
She was in that one show, Raising Something.
Raising
Martha,
Hope?
Martha Plimpton.
That's it, yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
Yeah, she's awesome, and that was a good show.
Yeah, so them. So, yeah, I mean, it's, yeah. I'm excited for it. I'm excited to see Robert Englund again back and acting. And apparently there was another quick thing with him. They really want him to do one more Nightmare on Elm Street. Which I don't and I do.
Dude, that horse has been beat.
Right. It's like
it's glue now. You guys are beating glue. It's
honestly,
not a dead horse. You guys are beating glue now.
The only way I would think they could pull it off if it was the one thing they haven't done, which was the prequel. Basically, the trial, the actual shit leading up to the trial.
That could work.
It could. Because I seen a short, a fan short, where they did, it was a fan short, it was like 10 minutes long, and it was in the actual confession room where he's giving his confession and everything. And honestly, I was like, yo, I could see this as a
wait,
film.
You'd be except okay
like
with
25, 30 years too late on
exactly,
that.
Exactly, yeah.
Right. Like, that's what I'm saying. That's the problem.
It's going to be some Robert De Niro shit with that movie that fucking Big Red made us watch us where that's fucking the- Robert Eglin's all...
De-aged. Yeah. That's shit. What I'm nah, saying. That's I'm the that. That's the hard part about
nah,
it.
Nah, I'm off that.
That's
shit,
the only
yeah, no.
way they could sell.
You're reaching for that one, man.
Another one. That's how I mean, and unless they have some grand scheme, I don't know. But that's the other thing. Like apparently they're trying to push for one more out of them, and I'm like,
just leave it alone.
All right. So you want to just leave 30 minutes for the movies or no? Because we could keep going, dude. We've only got two movies this time.
Well, technically, yeah, because he didn't get J.Dotville.
Yeah, I didn't get a chance to watch it.
No way.
Right,
what
so,
happened?
12-hour days and a newborn.
Fair enough.
Yeah,
fair enough.
So he didn't get J.Dotville. I mean, I got all three. I know.
I definitely want to do Nightcrawler. Nightcrawler.
Oh, what about Birdcage? No, dude. I didn't do... I mean, I don't want to review Nightcrawler. Like,
I mean, we can go through it real quick. All
right.
We all watched Birdcage, though.
Yes, we did.
Okay.
Yes, we did.
All right. So,
I forgot how great that movie was.
Quick Nightcrawler review. A quick one. Just because Red's not here, and I think it's unfair for him. But what I want to blast through these last few, because some of these are great. One, shout out to the Animaniacs reboot coming out with fire. If you get any controversy off your first new reboot season, I got nothing but love for you, baby. Apparently, they
Mice and Memes, dude. First of all, that title for Pinky and the Brain.
Bro, apparently they made a joke about Johnny Depp's situation.
Yes, they did.
And
I missed that one.
And apparently people are not happy. Now, I don't know. I'm Team Depp because fuck Amber Heard.
Everybody is, dude. Fuck
but
Amber Heard.
But the thing is, bro, comedy is comedy.
All I got to say to Johnny Depp is don't be a pussy and take a joke.
You know what I'm saying? Bro, you know?
You're a celebrity.
But
you're
I don't know if
like,
it's him or if it's just the fans, but...
Your ex-wife took a shit in the bed, man. You could take a joke, man.
Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not defending her actions.
No,
whatsoever.
By no means. By no means. No, right. No. Like,
but at the same time, if you're a celebrity, like,
we knew that, like, all this shit had came out. And understand, because they even make a joke about it, because in the first episode, they're joking, oh, well, this show premieres on 2020. But our writers did this in 2018, so we don't know who won the election.
Yeah.
That was literally one of the jokes on the fucking...
So they came out with the defense like the next day, like, hey, we kind of wrote this shit prior to everything happening, so our bad.
Yeah.
But either way, like, the fact of the matter is, y'all was headlining a week into your release. Like, a week or two into your release. Now I need to watch this. I will be
watching
this.
Oh, no, dude, it's fucking amazing, because one of the lyrics talks about gender-neutral... And, like, dude, like, they did away with a...
We might have... Actually, that'll probably be one of the reviews.
I'm okay with that.
We'll do, like, the first, the new, brand new season.
Yeah,
how
we can do that.
How many episodes is it?
Maybe 10. Hold on, let me check.
See, that's,
but, no, dude, but, like, they're half-hour episodes, so we're all good.
Perfect. Yeah, we'll do that, and we'll have to obviously do... I had a theme, by the way, for the picks. We're doing unconventional Christmas movies.
Ooh, so that means Deadpool.
That could be one.
Oh, wait.
If that's your pick, but I'm picking one. Because I didn't have a pick last episode. So.
What do you mean by unconventional? Do you mean like...
It's a Christmas movie, but people are like, no, it's not a Christmas movie. But you're like, no, it's a Christmas movie.
Damn, we already did Gremlins.
Yeah, exactly. Like that. Like that. That's a Christmas movie in my heart, but people won't see it as a Christmas movie because
it's
murdering.
Well, there's the most famous one. I don't even have to say it.
Mm. Die Hard.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you.
Yes. But yeah, so quick... a couple more. One, shout out to Rockstar. They're separating Red Dead Online, making that its own thing. Apparently starting on December 1st, and you can cop that for $5. So if you want to do that, get that. We talked about the bricking. Apparently Black Ops was bricking, the new one, the Cold War.
That's one, yeah. It was Cold War that was bricking. Dude, so that's the whole thing. You get a AAA title.
Mm-hmm.
A AAA title, and it's bricking your new fucking fancy Xbox.
Like, that's gotta suck.
Fuck out of here, dude.
See, EA needs to get smart, by the way, and release just the zombie games on its own thing.
You mean Treyarch.
Or Treyarch, right.
Yeah.
See, they need to do that, though, is just release just the zombie mode on its own thing with all the maps.
Pretty much.
With some new ones, because I would play that. Fuck Call of Duty, but I would play that one.
I'm on the other end of the spectrum where I just play strictly for the campaign.
So you're on the spectrum.
I am. Oh, definitely. No shame in that, dude. I know I'm on the spectrum somewhere.
Oh God, that's awesome.
Sorry.
Speaking of awesome things, one thing that I just saw that I thought was really cool. Nothing real big or interesting. I just thought it was neat.
Hold on. Let's pause for our cause real quick, and not to shit on Big Red. I'm sure he's watching. But I want to point out that we have not interrupted Chuck for a good part of this episode. I think Big Red's the instigator here. I love you, Big Red, but
is that why the night feels off?
Yeah.
Have you been interrupted?
You haven't been interrupted, brother.
That's because we haven't gotten to the reviews yet.
Oh, no. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. But I'm still riding that wave, dude.
Right. So far.
Yeah, I'm still riding that wave.
But yeah, so I thought this was really neat. Shout out to one of my crushes, Amelia Clark. I love her.
That improv speech, yes.
She apparently, it's 10 minutes, mind you, and it was in season 5, and it was an entire speech that she gave, and it was literally improvised.
Was that when, what scene was that, when she was freeing the slaves, or, because season 5, I think, is...
Let's see here, it was...
I don't remember what's what in each season.
First couple takes, wouldn't it be great if Cena was in Valerian? It was when she was like freeing people.
So it was the slaves. Yeah, it was when she went to that city and then she liberated the dude that fell in love with her handmaiden.
Yeah.
Okay.
What were they called? The Sullied or whatever.
Yeah, it was when Unsullied.
The Unsullied. Yeah, when she freed.
But yeah, she did 10 minutes straight improvisation. Like, I enjoyed her, one, because, I mean, first, like, obviously, you're like, damn, she's fine. But then, I started, like, watching some of her interviews. She is one of the most wholesome little fucking people.
Yes, she
is.
She's
adorable.
My God.
Oh, no, she's bae, dude. She's So, to me, she's second bae to, oh, my God, I forgot her name.
Anna Kendrick?
No, not Anna Kendrick.
She's another
one. No,
but
we're talking about Game of Thrones.
Sansa?
Maisie Williams. Yeah. Dude, she is a nerd. She, even though she's, I think, from Liverpool, she's got a bit of a Scottish brogue.
Is that
Arya?
Arya, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then, like, dude, she's such a goofball too, dude. And that's the other thing. Those are two of the most wholesome, because what it was is that though Sansa, I forgot her name. Fuck it, but. She's a fake redhead, and what it was is that when in the scene where Arya finally went for her,
yeah,
and then she's like, "Oh well, Arya got that pussy pounded," and she's like, "And that's the thesis." So that's not as wholesome as fucking Maisie Williams,
right?
And fucking
bro. And when I tell you, like, hey, it's interesting to see, like, one in a show like that. Like, you can do shit like that because you're speaking a fake language, so you're just kind of like, "Yeah, fuck it, I'm making up as I go." But, like, to go 10 minutes straight.
That's hard. That's really tough.
But, dude, I think that's dedication to your craft.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And also goes to prove that some of the best moments are fucking improvised.
They are.
I mean, that's why she's in movies now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, I mean, I enjoyed her in fucking Han Solo. I enjoyed her. I enjoyed her character.
I
enjoyed what they had in store for her down the road if it were have gotten a sequel. Because they fucking had Darth Maul.
Are you okay with... Shit. Would you fuck with her as Sarah Connor?
Yeah.
And, oh, like a young Sarah Connor?
Yeah. No, she was in Terminator. Was it Genesis? That one was Genesis, I think.
It was she?
Yeah. Yeah, she was a young Sarah Connor, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh. Yeah. No, I mean, she's got good acting chops. I'm excited for Marvel to pick her up at some point.
But
sure,
Maisie Williams, for example, she was in Genlock. Oh, my God. And just hearing her voice.
I heard
voice,
that was
dude, no,
Genlock.
No, dude, y'all should do yourselves a favor and find out if you all can get to Genlock. It's got fucking David Tennant.
Isn't it Michael B. Jordan, too, right?
And Michael B. Jordan and Maisie Williams. Enough said.
Nice.
Right there, dude. Like, you've got...
Oh, Tennant. Okay, yeah. I've seen the trailers for that. That looks pretty good.
Yeah, it looked interesting enough. I was like, I might watch that.
But that's
that.
The other
and
thing,
then
dude.
Like,
that's,
oh,
one of the first, Afro-produced animes. The only other one right now that, like... And black people are loving it, and even
Afro Samurai? No,
Well, I mean, that was kind of like borrowed, okay. But like these are like actual like people that came up with anime ideas for that is Cannon Busters,
okay,
on Netflix, and it's the guy's name is Philly the Kid or Philly something, but he actually went to Japan, wrote the manga, got an anime there, and then he fucking brought it back to the States. That's a fucking flex right there.
That is.
Yeah.
That is a big
And I got to show you the intro for that song because that song fucking slaps.
Nice.
We'll listen to it post-show. Right. And if y'all want to, we can put it up online. Just let us know.
Do that.
So,
but yeah, and then two real quick, one more funny but still sad. So the show Wipeout apparently had a death.
So it was a heart attack, and it was after the course, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay,
so it wasn't like. It was a freak accident.
Yeah, no, it wasn't a freak accident. What it was is that I think he went through the obstacle course.
And then just...
And then had a heart attack. So, honestly, that's more on the medical people than the actual production staff. Now, obviously, there's going to be things that have to be looked at and reviewed and everything like that. But, honestly, I don't think it should deny us from having a good show.
I mean, realistically, it's up to the... I would give it up to the person's people who... care over the estate and so on.
I could totally understand if they didn't want it to be seen, the episode itself. I totally get it. It's purely out of respect.
Yeah.
Right.
But if they decide to show it, I respect that too.
For
you
me,
know?
If it was me and I'm like, yo, y'all better air that motherfucking
show. I think I've told you about this, but Chuck, you don't know this. I actually got into the top 50 one time to be on a reality show on NBC. And it was to do the most dangerous jobs in America. And one of the things I remember, because they're like, yo, you need to have a flight ready. It was to the point where, they asked me for my measurements. And they had me sign a W-9 at one point.
Damn.
That's how close I got to, being on the show. But one of the things is that they tell you is that, look, you know that you can lose your life on this. I was like, yeah, bet. Let's fucking go. But it's just that, understand that, people take these risks. So, yeah, it's tragic that this dude... had this happen, but then on the other hand, the show shouldn't be fucking, unless the show did something with blatant disregard, which I don't think they did, and if they do, I'll change my opinion. You heard it here now.
Right.
But the show shouldn't have any, there's no blood, there shouldn't be any blood on the show's hands for this, you know?
No.
Because, I mean, obviously they had doctors on site and everything. And if the guy died from a heart attack right then and there, then it had to have been a cardiac arrest or something like that.
Yeah, I don't fault anybody, honestly. Because it kind of is a freak accident in a way, but it's not like the course was malfunctioning or anything like that. It's just...
Evidently the guy ran... shit happens. Evidently the contestant ran the course and then he collapsed and it was a heart attack.
Right.
So...
That can happen to anybody, anytime.
Absolutely.
Anywhere.
That's just crazy.
Still sad, though.
Mm-hmm.
May he rest in peace.
May they? I don't know. He or...
Or she. I'm not
he or
sure.
She? Do we know if it was a he or a she? Or may they rest in peace? Yeah, that's...
Close enough.
Let's do that.
Yeah. All right, move on to a happier...
sort of happier. Kind of funny, actually, but sort of like, wow, you apparently are there. Last article of the evening. Pat Sajak has finally hit that point of his life.
Fuck you, Sajak, you climate science denying piece of
apparently,
shit.
Apparently.
He's a Leaf too, right?
What's up?
He's a Leaf too, right?
A leaf?
Canadian.
I don't know if he is. Oh, a maple. I call him or leafer. Leafer or maple. So,
so apparently on one of an episode or a taping, there was a puzzle for things that begin with the word kitchen. McBain, one of the contestants.
His name's McBain. Right. Like Simpsons.
guessed.
Mendoza!
He guessed cabinet, towels, oven, sink. After winning the puzzle, McBain asked about one of the answers. He said, kitchen oven? What was that? Who calls it a kitchen oven? And a lot of fans apparently agreed. That he's like, who calls it a kitchen oven? But apparently, Sajak did not. Because
Have bathroom ovens?
I don't know.
No, it's just that's the life of privilege. That you're so fucking, that motherfucker has not set foot in his kitchen. That's why, look, all right, here it goes. Hot take. Y'all ready for this?
Pat Sajak was right.
No, fuck that. Cancer should have taken Sajak and not Trebek. My hot take.
I don't wish cancer on anybody.
Wait, hold on. In this situation, though. In this situation.
I told you. I warned y'all.
The wrong host died.
In this situation, the contestant was like, who says that? And then Pat Sajak was like, don't. You won. Don't argue, Darren. You got the puzzle, ungrateful players. I've had it. Yo!
What a privileged
cancer,
piece of shit.
Cancer,
how did he say it, though?
Cancer took the wrong
He's
host.
Like, and then he goes on later and says, I'm sorry I yelled at you.
No,
it's just,
fuck you.
I don't remember your mother giving us trouble like you did.
Whoa!
Exactly, no.
All I gotta say is, wow, I've been on TV for 30 years. Fuck my life.
Yeah.
No,
fuck you,
shit.
Fuck you, Say Jack. Cancer took the wrong host. I'm sticking to my guns.
I mean, look.
Chuck is like, I don't even want to touch that shit.
Look. Is he wrong for going off? Maybe a little. Is the contestant being a little bit of a prick? Yeah.
Dude, this guy made it to fucking TV.
Where's
the
video
on Wheel
footage?
Of Fortune. And this guy's been hosting the show for 30 years. He's had a good life. Like, sorry, but your job's pretty fucking easy compared to what a lot of people do.
Listen,
oh, yeah.
Listen. All right, let's take bets right now. Has fucking Pat Sajak stepped into a kitchen and done something to feed himself?
No.
Exactly.
No.
Exactly. So fuck you,
and
Sajak.
It's probably been quite some time since he has.
Exactly. So fuck you,
but
Sajak.
But he's not the one who questioned why they call it a kitchen oven.
No, it doesn't matter, but he got butthurt about it. Because that's how privilege fucking.
Oh, honestly, that was the answer was kitchen oven.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
And the contestant was like, "Who calls it a kitchen oven?" And Pat Sajak was like, "Bitch, you just won something. Shut up."
No,
the contestant's right too.
Thank
like,
you. Yes,
because
thank you.
Like, where else are you gonna keep your fucking oven? Like outside, you're gonna keep it in the bathroom. You're gonna keep it in your living room. I leave mine in the garage because you know why not.
I leave mine in the patio, and I have my personal chef take care of it.
I mean, devil's advocate, who really gonna sit there and critique it? Oh, why'd you call it a kitchen oven? Like,
I would have.
Like, who fucking cares?
Who cares?
Like, how much money have you made hosting this show?
Exactly.
Just fucking deal with
but
it.
Millions. You
read the card.
Millions. Hold up. This guy just won $15,000. He's bitching because. Who calls it a kitchen oven?
No,
because
he's right though. Like
the wrong host.
Do you ever? Because like, oh, I have a frozen pizza. Let me throw
you
it in the kitchen oven here. Let me go ahead and preheat that kitchen oven.
Maybe the word oven was too easy to get.
No, but like nobody says the kitchen oven.
No one does. No,
rich
it's
people
the
do.
Oven. Exactly.
What are you
no,
talking
privilege,
about?
Privileged white people say that.
But I mean, he won. Point.
You got the kitchen oven. You got the basement oven.
Here's the thing. He
you got
won.
The oven upstairs.
Get out, sir.
You know what I'm
get
saying?
The fuck out.
I don't know. I'm not German. I don't keep 20 ovens in my house.
Whoa! Holy shit!
Wow, you really decided to one up me, huh?
Red's not here, so I gotta fill.
Lotto was a spice in me.
But seriously, though,
you couldn't.
No
you
one
couldn't,
fucking
you,
says kitchen oven.
You couldn't
oven.
Let me have the limelight.
Just
huh?
saying, man.
No, you know who doesn't have the say limelight. You know who doesn't say kitchen oven? Poor people. All yeah. right.
Oh,
call it down.
They got stove
Maybe
top.
It's a Canadian yeah, thing.
They got
that's
stove
it. Top. They got hot plates.
Fuck. Let me say this one more time. Fuck you, Say Jack. Cancer took the wrong host.
Lord.
All right,
hey, hey.
We were smooth sailing up till this point.
Right.
If it wasn't for Vanna White, that show.
This
would
is
have
why
been.
I left this article for last, specifically for this reason. But all right, so we're gonna get into these reviews.
Yay!
Let's do this. We got 40 minutes left. Three reviews.
Wow, really?
But we're gonna piss through the Nightcrawler review right now because the person who picked it is not here. Nightcrawler, Jake Gyllenhaal, basically is a psychotic fucking jobless
cloud
man.
Cloud chaser.
Sure, cloud chaser.
He was, I mean, in my opinion.
He's too fucking smart for his own good, though. That's
he,
the thing about that.
Yeah. I think has a mental condition.
Narcissism. He goes from sociopath to psychopath.
And
I thought it was narcissism. I thought maybe.
A little bit of it's honestly call him A, B, and C.
He's got sociopathic tendencies because he has no problem using people to get what he wants. You know?
And he's psychopathic.
Hey, why don't you just tag me next time?
What?
Nothing.
What?
You guys missed it.
Get out. Get out.
Oh, because sociopathic, narcissistic. Yeah.
Just tag me next time, bro.
Gotcha.
Yeah, sorry. Sorry.
But yeah, so.
You're not that important, sir.
I'll mute myself.
So the
you're a Browns
the name
fan.
Of the movie Nightcrawler is derived from, I guess, their jobs where the people that are out in the middle of the night getting these breaking news stories.
These scoops and shit, yeah.
The scoops being first on the scene. I guess they refer to themselves as Nightcrawlers.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't check the facts on this, but it seemed pretty close to what you would
Paxton's
expect.
Character says Nightcrawling.
Right.
So it
kind
of alludes to that.
And R.I.P. Paxton, bro. Though his part was minimal, he still hit the mark
as he normally does.
But
this movie was a while for me, so I didn't see it was a while since I seen it, but still I still remember. And this is one of those movies almost uncut gems where to me I've never enjoyed watching the bad guy from a perspective, you know. And this guy was he wasn't a bad guy, but he turned into a bad guy, you know, and I'm not too fond of those transitions or that story.
See, I slight half disagree with you. I think he was a bad guy the whole time. Because you open up the film, the first scene is him trying to steal copper and wire and shit. Because, yes, he does, excuse me, he doesn't have a job, whatever.
He's a hustler.
Sure.
Yeah.
He's trying to do what he's got. But then he does whatever. We don't know what happens to the dude that he takes the watch from.
Yep.
We don't know if he killed him. We don't know if he just knocked his shit out and then took this shit and left. I don't know. Mm-hmm. But I was like, oh, okay, this is how we're starting. Interesting.
Yeah.
And then it just kind of goes from there. He gets into the, you know, being on the scene shit and gets a camera. He's hustling.
Buys a fucking Challenger, the white douchebag fucking, that is the white douchebag Porsche right there.
Yo, honestly, Jake Gyllenhaal is a solid actor.
And he did the role well, yeah.
He did. And he really made me hate him, like, throughout this whole movie. Like, absolutely. I wanted to root for him.
But you wanted to see him fail.
Like when he first started getting into it, how into it he was, mm-hmm. I was like, okay, he's got a passion for this. All right. Because here is the thing. This movie, I never watched a trailer for. I didn't really even read anything.
Really?
So I just knew it was Jake Gyllenhaal. He had something to do with reporting.
Yeah.
I honestly thought he was a legitimate reporter. And then I see this movie, and I'm like, oh, he's going to be a serial killer. He didn't become a serial killer.
He has that vibe, though.
I thought it was going that direction.
We're talking about
right, because the whole him trying to be on the scene as quick as he could, I thought it was going to lead to him killing people and then being like, "I was on the scene there, guys." You know, Dexter style and shit. But no, that's not where it went at all. You know, honestly,
really he diddled Rene Russo. He diddled Rene Russo, and that was not fucking
good. Yeah, and like,
but I liked it. They do that though because it shows like how like cutthroat and like disgusting depraved how the media is, like,
and again
we want the most disgusting footage we could find to put fear into the
broke it down for her the ratings and the station
and again
he keeps saying though he's a fast learner and he does prove that throughout the movie
and again that goes to show that like to me this movie did not hold up well as The Birdcage. And it's only because now...
Well, apples to oranges.
hear me out. What it was is that, to me, it's just that, like, now all these kids that are cloud chasers and shit, like, for example, I want to say this was maybe 3 years ago, there was a girl that was driving drunk, killed her sister, and then fucking did it all on Snapchat. She was driving drunk, and then she's like, oh, shit, my sister's dead. Ah, I'm out here. Like, that type of shit. And then that's what, like... Nightcrawler would have been. That's what this guy would have been. You know, this it's shit like that. Like, you know, they feed into that rush and into that like adulation almost. Because he was doing it for the money, but once he figured out like the ratings and everything, adulation. That's what it was.
Just
the
how far can I go?
Yeah, exactly. He pushed the envelope to where.
I mean, there was also the fact that he wanted to build himself into something, which he had that aspiration the whole time.
Yeah.
So I get that. Understandable. Cool. Whatever. I hated his character. I hated how he treated homeboy.
Yep.
I hate how...
Poor Rick.
I hated how he did Rick. Like, that shit right there. Fucking... That shit hurt, bro. I was like, yo. Like, because I was hating him this whole time. And then that really, like, I was like, yo, the bad guy won. The bad guy. Fuck it. It was like walking out of Infinity War.
And to me, no. Well, don't sully Infinity War.
Well, I'm not sully, but like the fact that the bad guy won, basically.
With a great value fucking version of fucking Uncut Gems.
Just
okay, this is my hill to die on. Nightcrawler's better than Uncut Gems.
Oh.
I like it better.
Fair enough.
Uncut Gems is, it's okay.
I disagree.
I was waiting for it to end.
I think Uncut Gems for me was more like.
All right. So, what's your favorite scene on that one?
For Nightcrawler, I guess honestly, it would probably be.
That's a tough call.
It's a tough call, but it would probably be when. He first, he just kind of walks up into the fucking studio. One, you just, is that how studios are? Like, motherfucker could just walk up like, hey, where do I get footage? who I get footage to? Like, that's cool? Like, I don't know.
Clout chasing.
It's more like shaving off unnecessary time in a movie.
Yeah.
So they don't have to worry about that.
I'm not trying to live in this is supposed to be real as fuck, but like, come on, like, what? But okay, whatever. But the how he handled the situation with the footage, like how him basically brokering the first deal, kind of like, well, let me get a G. Like, I got to give him credit on that.
So that's your scene.
Yeah, yeah. It's a toss up between that and the dinner.
Rating?
6.5.
Chuckles. Damn.
Yeah, Chuck.
See, this is my second time seeing this movie, honestly. And if Red wasn't going to pick it, I was going to pick it.
Really?
It was on my list. Jake Gyllenhaal surprised the hell out of me on this one. I always did like him as an actor, but I think he did really well in this one because he's just... He looks dead on the inside the entire movie.
Oh, no, no.
Like,
he's in fucking, it for money. He's a parasite.
Yeah, he's a parasite.
Yeah.
He's a sociopath. He's looking for a quick buck. He's in that... You know, you could tell that from the beginning that he's just looking for money. And I like his... I just like watching him grow because this movie actually gives me anxiety because I am not like him whatsoever.
Yeah.
It gives me anxiety because it's like, no, I wouldn't fucking do that. I wouldn't
go
in there.
Yeah.
I'm with you, Joe.
However, like, I just like the progression of him, like, realizing that he has potential in this, I guess, field, whatever you want to call it, this job. And he just grows this, you know, network. But I like watching him just, like, I don't know. Watching someone dead on the inside have a light turn on almost, but in an evil way. It's just sadistic, you know?
Yeah. Fair enough.
But I like his... I just like the movie. I do. It's fucked up. It's morbid.
Yeah.
I like... just Jake Gyllenhaal is awesome.
Yeah, no, one, and honestly, like, it reminded me slightly of Breaking Bad. Like, you started at the beginning doing this as a necessity, and then you were like, oh, fuck, I'm really good at
Except
this.
Walter White actually had, morals.
And then he had... Well, but
exactly,
then,
that's...
Like...
That's where I hate this guy, too, so...
But...
There's no gray
but
area.
He also admits it... You know, spoiler alert, I mean, it's a dead show, but, you know, at the end, he basically at a certain point became, I liked it.
Yeah.
He said, we're
good at it.
We're not in the meth business, we're in the empire business. That's what he said, you know.
That conversation still sticks with me today.
I would love to review Breaking Bad. Too many seasons.
Right, yeah. No,
God, I love that show.
Yeah, no, that conversation, though, when he broke it down for her in the end.
So, Chuckles, what was your favorite scene on that one?
That's a tough call. Probably... I think it was the last one they filmed.
Mm-hmm.
The car chase and all of that.
Yeah.
Just, you see the whole thing going down.
Visceral.
Yeah. Because, like, you see, like, him set up, like, his own videos and...
Exactly. Like, it's almost like he's staging it.
There was basically a murder.
Mm-hmm.
And he goes and films them leaving. The murderer's leaving. He goes in and sees, like, all the dead people and they submit the video. So then he basically sets up the murderers just so he can film it and have it, you know. That's a sociopathic thing.
Absolutely.
But then the film that, then the entire car chase, and then film his partner getting shot and dead on the ground. Like, that's his true character. His true colors right there.
Yeah, it
is. The whole scene's fucked up, but it's so, you know, entertaining and just, like, watching him
well, thing
this,
is,
like, how is he going to get out of this? Like,
when it happened, it was one thing. You're like, oh, shit, no, not Rick. But then... When you realize, because at first it didn't hit me as hard because I didn't realize that, he was like, you saw him. You knew.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You set me up, you son of a bitch.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And let him get blasted to hell.
Yep.
That was it. I was like, wow. That was basically.
And it's, if you think about it, it's almost like he knew that Rick would eventually catch on and be able to bargain against him.
Yeah.
That's why he had him.
So he just had him killed.
That's why he set him up that way.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I'm sorry, what was your rating? Did I get your rating or no?
I'm probably going to be the odd man out on this one, except for Red, whenever he does eventually talk about this movie. I like this movie a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I'd probably give it 8.5.
All right. So, to me, and look, we went through our first review without interrupting Chuck. Go fucking figure.
Sort of.
So to me, this movie has not aged very well. And it's only because, like I said, of the cloud chasing, of what you see in social media now. Like,
but I don't do social media.
No, and you're absolutely
so
right about that.
Different
but
perspective.
But,
you know?
So to me, this guy was ahead on his time, and I'll give him credit for that. But the thing is how he leveraged things. Yes, it was a very smart thing to do. And I think that's the difference between the asshole in Uncut Gems and this guy. Whereas Uncut Gems was more reactive, this guy was more calculated.
Yes.
And that's probably my only... probably the only credit that I'll give that guy.
Speaking of Uncut Gems and all that, it did remind me a little bit of Robert Pattinson in Good Times.
Yes.
That!
Yes, it did.
Because he's very much like, I'm going to write this moment kind of thing.
Yeah,
but he was also very calculated compared to against him.
And the thing is...
This could have been an A24 movie, though.
And the thing is that I think I respect Jake Gyllenhaal a little bit more just because of that. because he took this character and it was more calculated.
Yeah.
He brought his stacks up and everything. Don't get me wrong. I still was not a fan of the movie because of the shit that he did. But the thing was, is that whereas Adam Sandler in Uncut Gems was more reactive, this guy was more calculated. So that's why he appealed to me a little bit
just
more.
Just little things like when you watch him take over the company or his company, he's like, Rick, I think you're doing great when you're filling up the challenger. And he's like, however, you did spill gasoline on the paint and that could chip it and I will fire you. And it's just like, you could see it just like, boom, turn off a switch.
Yeah. But the thing is that it's still... This is still a piece of shit. So
no, he's a total piece of shit. Yeah.
So to me, honestly, well, it was a great ride. The credits is going to be my favorite scene, and I'm going to give it a 2 at least. So
you gave it,
You
gave it a lower score than
No. Uncut Gems was a 0.25. This is a 2. So I gave it a quarter of a point for Uncut Gems. So this is at least a 2. This is at least a 2 points.
6.5. You said 8.5?
And whoever Red gives it, probably closer to what I gave it, I'm guessing.
I mean, Jake Gyllenhaal killed it, for sure. But
I mean,
he did,
but again, the calculations, that's what made me respect him. Whereas this piece of shit in fucking Uncut Gems...
I guess I just like the morbidity of the whole movie.
No, I agree. I fucking really hated him the whole time.
Even then, but
that's the thing I like about it.
Right.
He made me hate him.
And you see, to me, I just can't be entertained by people that I hate, if that makes sense. And I think that's why I never liked. And going back, and I don't know if we'll ever review this, but that's why I never enjoyed Scarface, because I knew where this was going. You know, and it's the same thing when I watch Scarface or Uncut Gems or Nightcrawler. It's like, well, Nightcrawler is the exception because the bad guy actually gets away with it. Whereas with the other ones, like, it's almost like a cautionary tale, you know. But that being said, I respect his character because his character definitely was not as reactive as Adam Sandler or Al Pacino in their respective movies. This guy actually planned his shit out.
Yeah.
So I was like, all right, I'm going to fuck with you on this, you know, even though it's still fucked up.
Until he went and got real stupid with it. Like, smartness, respect it, it's just, wow. Like,
the thing is that with a lot of these movies, it always shows that greed eventually overpowers everything else. Forget how methodical or how, like, smart or how many moves you've planned. Eventually, that power and greed seduces you. Exactly. And then, like, you know.
Even in this case, too, I mean, this is one of the cases where they're like, and he wins.
That's one of the other reasons I at least gave it 2 points. So,
honestly, I didn't hate the movie. It's definitely an interesting flick.
One thing I did want to mention, by the way, that I noticed the second time through, but not the first one, the soundtrack. The soundtrack does not fit the atmosphere of the movie, but it works so well for it.
Yeah, yeah.
It's because it's like, it's almost like a post-rock, almost like ambient, like a... Not even upbeat, but like a major key thing. It's different.
Exactly what you're saying, because a lot of those moments where he gets those shots.
It's almost ethereal. What was the word? Ethereal?
Ethereal, yeah.
It's almost ethereal
like,
in a way.
Like those moments where he gets those shots, those beautiful, like the ones that he knows he's going to be able to sell and shit.
You can see that he's
you
like,
hear
it's
the
clicking
music.
His brain.
It's like in those artistic movies where the person finally gets that painting or starts finally hitting those notes and making the song.
But the contrast of that and the fact that
he's
filming crime scenes.
Yes!
It's like, that worked so well.
It was an interesting contrast.
All right, so what do you want to review next?
We are going up next with The Birdcage.
Yes!
So Chuck picked this one.
Give us a synopsis, Chuck, if you will, sir.
Go ahead, man.
I don't have the thing pulled up.
All right, pull it up, man. We'll have a sip here. We'll shoot the shit, man.
Shoot the shit real quick.
Dude, what a great fucking movie. And the thing is that it still holds up till now.
Yes.
Yes.
This one, and there's one thing, and look, okay, first off, I'm going to preface this this review with one. Can we please, please, please do our best to try to stay as apolitical as possible, because this is not a political show, okay? Okay?
We have
because
moments,
there's,
but it's not.
There is going to be one thing that I have to bring up that I found extremely interesting,
Bo.
And I don't want to go too far into it, because we could spend way too much time on
Bo,
it.
Okay? You should have told me that.
For anything political.
Bo,
whatsoever.
You should have told me that when I was not 3 mini bottles of wine.
I'm going to trust you to keep cool here, but go ahead.
So, first of all,
I
did not pick
that
this movie for any political point of view. Right, right. Just family. No politics. No, it's
beautiful, dude.
It's in a well-casted movie that yes. held up extremely well for no, it being does. It what, does. 24 years old. Yes.
25 almost now.
Yeah. Mm. God. 1996. Yeah. Jeez. That's hard to believe.
So go ahead.
In this remake of the classic French farce, I'm not going to fucking pronounce this correct. Le Cage.
The Parahu.
Yeah, whatever. Engaged couple Val Goldman and Barbara Keeley shakily introduce their future-in-laws. Val's father, Armand, a gay Miami drag club owner, pretends to be straight and attempts to hide his relationship with Albert, his life partner in the club's flamboyant star attraction. So as to please Barbara's father, controversial Republican Senator Kevin Keeley. Mm. So,
yeah.
This movie, once again.
Hijinks ensue.
Extremely well casted.
Oh, my God.
You get Robin Williams, Hank Nathan Lane, who have Hank Azaria, amazing chemistry.
Yeah,
Hank Nathan Azaria, Lane, dude. Who, if you don't know, it does a million voices on The Simpsons, including Chief Wiggum.
Yeah.
He's.
I don't know why my parents were so.
even his voice sounds like a Simpsons character. Yeah. You can just picture, like, close your eyes and picture him as a yellow character. Yeah. He's so fucking good in that movie. Just. I don't know, to watch it like back in 96 when being openly gay wasn't as accepted as it was now.
Just becoming...
Yeah. It kind of was, yeah. It was like the beginning of it.
One more thing, and sorry, Chuck, I know that
there's interruption.
Yeah, there it is. Sorry, bro. But no, I just want to point out, I just want to point out that if we're going left, then that means you're next. That's all I want to point out.
Oh, yeah.
All right, okay. Go ahead. Continue.
I just love this movie because it's... an all-around blast.
It is.
It's
oh
hilarious.
My fucking God.
Robin Williams, I'm sorry. I grew up in, you know, the 90s. I love Robin Williams. I love everything he's been in. And that movie in particular, he's fantastic.
Yes.
Nathan Lane and Robin Williams are great together. I wish they had done other stuff. I really do.
They do. Their chemistry together in this movie was fucking great.
The banter, just like, you would swear they really were a married couple kind of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. It
if
really
I may
is.
Pause for a cross, Chuck, R.I.P. Robin Williams. But
oh, absolutely.
It would have been great if they could have done... That is a reboot that I would have watched.
I wouldn't have seen a reboot. But, a sequel.
But no. A sequel. A sequel. And it's just when those two have grandkids and how that whole family is going to react.
So you're going to meet the fuckers.
Basically. Yeah. But it would have been great, dude, because...
Hey, Meet the Fuckers was good.
Fucking Armand and fucking Albert fucking... Being grandmothers, like,
oh
Albert,
God.
Albert, oh, I'm old. I'm disheveled and shit.
See, like, if Robin Williams was still around, they could have easily done that.
Oh,
and it would have been hysterical.
No, that would have worked.
Oh, no, that
really
would have been
well.
A train I would have gone on.
Oh, yeah, it would have worked well in today's age.
But as you will, again, as you were, sir.
I absolutely love this movie. Once again, chemistry. That's all it is in this movie.
Beautiful.
The chemistry.
Oh, yeah.
Beautiful.
Oh, yeah, so.
Just to have the contrast of, like, how Rob Williams' character is so... He's one of the, like, straight acting gays, I guess. Mm. And then Nathan Lane's just extremely flamboyant. So anytime he tries to act straight, I love it.
God, if I may say something. Again, sorry. Look, there are roles that certain actors are born for to play.
Mm.
He does anything
Ryan Reynolds?
Well,
no,
though.
Ryan Reynolds was born to play Deadpool.
Yeah.
Chris Evans was born to play fucking Captain America.
Facts.
Nathan Lane was born to play Albert. Sorry, like...
I think Nathan Lane's awesome.
And sorry, it's a goddamn shame that he didn't even get recognized by the Academy for that fucking role, dude.
That is a
it
shame.
Is.
That is he a was, fucking shame, dude.
He was really funny in his tiny role in 30 Rock, too. I don't know if you guys...
Oh, yeah. That and that. His... I think he was also on Family Guy for a while, too, if I'm not mistaken.
Was he?
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised.
His Family Guy. There
he
was
does a lot of
else.
Bit parts.
I forgot what it was.
But no, again, we're interrupting Chuck, so let's stay on let's
but
stay
hold
on
up,
target.
Hold up. There was one thing I wanted to bring up. Again, please, can we try to just keep it as okay, so the part where Calista Flockhart, who's 18.
Yeah, that was problematic.
That was the only thing. The kids were the only two that didn't fit their age roles whatsoever.
Oh, no. Not only that, but no. Fucking Gene Hackman tells her at the beginning, "You're not even 18, dude." That was a little bit problematic.
Like, are you sure?
No, it's funny because as a kid, you're like, "Oh, okay."
Yeah. You know? Now I'm like,
"Yeah, you watch all the movies.
Pump your brakes, pump."
But no.
Your brakes.
So when she's in the bathroom or the room or whatever, they're talking about it, And he's like, well, the mom's trying to spin everything. Like, we can do the wedding. Yeah. Da, da, da. And then he mentions we can get the Pope's too controversial. Then he says Billy Graham is too liberal.
See, the thing is, that's tongue in cheek.
But even so, even so, the funny thing about that is now. Well, Billy Graham, rest in peace.
He's died like four times already. I swear.
Mandela.
I know twice for sure.
It really is.
Twice for sure. For sure, for sure. Because shout out to G. G was the one that brought that up, actually. He had posted something about that on Facebook about Billy Graham.
All right, so I'm going to get one of your beers so I can bite my tongue. That's what I'm going to
do. There's one in the fridge. But no, honestly, it was just, I found it hilarious because that was, you know, at the time, obviously, it's tongue in cheek, but there's some truth to the joke that was considered liberal.
Actually, surprisingly, like, the Republican Party is a lot more accepting of that than they ever were. Mm. It's just how it is now. But I think it was absolutely tongue in cheek.
Yeah.
Because I guarantee, I don't know who wrote it. I didn't look it up. Mm. I guarantee they're liberal.
Well, and that's the funny somebody would say Billy Graham now, you'd be like, oh, you're more far-right.
That's
right-sided.
An absolute joke, yeah.
Which that's all I was like, that's pretty hilarious.
Even on The Simpsons, they had a funny joke where Homer and the family somehow came up with some Amish people.
Mm.
And he's like, oh, you look just like, you know, Flanders. He's like, Ned Flanders? He's like, oh, yeah, that ultra-liberal cousin of mine, you know, which was pretty funny.
But, yeah, it was a really hilarious take on the whole idea of conservatism and everything.
It took it tongue-in-cheek into extreme.
Yeah, it was solid satire.
And it was funny. Oh, it absolutely solid was.
Satire.
Oh, yeah.
Well, and the thing is, it was satire that spoke true to life, because those are pretty much the type of shit that they would get caught doing. Yes, like Joe just literally said, shout out to the Joe. It's because so many of them have been busted for being closeted.
Yeah!
My favorite, though, and sleeping with twink prostitutes.
Lindsey Graham, we're looking at you, bro.
Hey!
No, yeah. Lady G, that's what they call her. Lady. Ooh. Yeah, that's what they call Senator Lindsey Graham. Lady G.
I swear, it's one big gay club or something. Yeah. I don't know.
But, I mean, the satire is there. That's why it holds up so well, because... It's true to life.
Fuck you, Bo. This actually tastes good.
All right.
Yeah, those are actually pretty
good. Yo, it's the blackberry one. It's delicious. But yeah, so what is your favorite scene?
I don't know if I have a favorite scene in particular. It's more so anytime Nathan Lane tries to act straight, it kills me. Because it's a straight man playing a gay man trying to be a straight man, and we are so there.
Oh, because God, that is mine as well. The scene where he's learning to be a man,
yes.
Bro.
Yes,
I had to pause it because I was like, hold on,
dying of laughter, dude.
I want to hear what they were saying, because the way Robin Williams.
Not only that, but when he slaps him, and he's like, and then the old guy turns around, he's like, no, it's okay. He's like,
dude, the walk. Go walk.
He's like, look, I know it's cliche, John Wayne getting off his horse. Howdy, ma'am.
You kind of had to hunch.
Not only that, but then he grabs his fucking sun hat and tries to turn.
Yo, and he's trying to. He's doing things with the pinky.
Keep it down.
Oh, yeah, dude, that whole thing and the whole him trying to learn how to be man. Yo. That, yeah.
So good. It holds up so well.
It does, dude. It does.
What's your score?
Oh, God. This movie. It's hard to say because, like we said, you know, way back when Dennis was still doing the shit with us, like, comedy's different.
Yeah.
I held comedy on a higher scale because it always gets shit on.
Right.
I'm going to give this 8.7. It holds up so well.
I can fucks with that. Yeah, no. I honestly, yeah, the whole movie itself, the ensemble, the cast. Everything about it, it spoke 90s. It was totally Miami 90s for sure.
Oh, yeah.
I
don't know if like someone in their young 20s might understand all the references and like the feel of the time, but the jokes are still there.
Yeah, yep. I mean, honestly, the jokes all still work pretty fucking well, yes. Honestly. The him getting married, how both devastated they were about it. Like how Nathan Lane neglects to even acknowledge it in the morning for like a whole almost minute. He's like, wait, what? Like,
real quick though, have you guys ever watched Baskets?
Yes.
I know that's with Zach Galifianakis though, right?
And Louis Anderson.
The show is actually really funny. Louis Anderson as a woman is hysterical. I think Nathan Lane could have been amazing in that role too.
Oh, without a doubt. I think
nailed it.
Nathan Lane would have fucking nailed that role.
Yeah, no.
Louis Anderson surprised me in that one though.
I mean, and the thing is, like, what's crazy about it is, it's like, you see the absurdity of Nathan Lane, right?
Oh yeah.
You see how overdramatic he gets, but
he hams it the fuck up, dude.
Bro, like, but that moment,
dick.
Yes. And in that moment they have where they're all suited up in the room, like, that's that one, like, because you know commies always have that heart punch moment.
Oh yeah.
That one, it's crazy because I didn't see it coming, but I saw it coming, and I didn't it's so weird because I expected it but didn't at the same time, to be like, ooh, that one, yeah, that
but
hurt.
It tells you to accept those that are not the
right.
same as
thank you.
You.
And
thank
then
you.
He it comes back well. Later as the mom. Yo!
No, the thing is that, like, honestly, and that to me, that's why this movie to me has a underrated beauty behind mm-hmm. it. Because oh, this yeah. is the first time that a gay couple was recognized as human beings.
Mm-hmm.
Like, fucking Val recognized Albert as his mom. There was no substitute.
Right.
Like,
right.
that's what it was. Like, he even tells the senator, like, no, this is what would have been. And I'll get to that point later, but that's the beauty of this fucking
oh, yeah.
movie.
Oh, yeah.
And it's because it humanizes it from the 90s, and that's why this movie holds up so well now. It's because in the 90s, gay people were like, oh, comic relief. No, this is showing depth, emotion. Like, mm-hmm. when Val tells, because that's the whole thing, Val trusted Armand to tell Albert, like, look, he can't be here. But Val actually, like, there's actual hurt behind that.
Mm-hmm.
It might be dramatic and everything like that, but, like, yo, that's still your fucking family, dude.
Right, exactly. Like, no, and just honestly, one, too, and then the opposite side of it is seeing how he interacts with the family yeah. and when they take him as him being a woman and how the senator was pretty much yeah. kind of
oh,
getting
yeah.
a crush on him and shit.
I also like how
that was the best.
That shit was fucking hilarious.
You made me think about it. Back in the 90s, when you saw, like, a gay person on TV, they were always very flamboyant. Mm-hmm. They had a lisp, always mm-hmm. bright colors. I like how they had that. But then they had Robin Williams, who was, you would have never known.
A straight man, almost, yeah. if you will. Like,
yeah, like a yeah. straight acting gay person. I like how they kind of just took that and opened your eyes to that. Like, not all gay people are flamboyant.
Right, you
know?
Exactly.
And that really wasn't a thing yeah. back then, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Joe, I got your Philadelphia right here, pal.
Oh, God.
He said, depth and emotion like Philadelphia, right, Joe? And he also said it deserves more than 7.1 on IMDb, to be honest.
Yes, oh, it yeah. does.
Facts.
Oh, yes, it does.
Yeah, no,
like I said, dude.
Especially,
like,
now, like, watching it now, it's
again,
2020, and
again,
it's still just as hilarious.
Again, okay. It is a fucking crime that Nathan Lane didn't get nominated.
Mm-hmm.
Then no recognition at all.
Yeah.
All right, Bodinks, what's your favorite scene?
Yeah, well, no, favorite scene was definitely, I agree with Chuck, was when he's learning how to be a man. Dude, God, everything about that, bro, the you got to smear it. Like, when he goes to get the...
Hey, there's always more toast.
But honestly, though, what I liked about that scene, one, not only is it hilarious, but you can also see that his character kind of gets a little bit like, maybe I should kind of take back some of my craziness a little bit. Let me dial it in, because he's like, you know what? Yeah, there is more toast. I think he learned a little bit from
yeah.
that, but it was just hilarious.
Yeah.
I mean, especially with the mustard,
yeah.
where how Robert Williams explains it, because fuck, he's right.
Because there's actual character growth and development.
Yeah, but he's so right. I didn't think about this until I seen this shit, where he's like, you got to smear it on. I'm like, holy fuck, he's right, bro. Like,
men smear,
where some other more dainty people will dab it on. And I'm like, holy shit. But everything about it, the language, yeah. the pinky, the walk.
The slapping.
Fuck. The walk up to him where he's like, how you doing? The handshake. Dude.
Hey, fourth and third on the Dolphins. What do you think about that? And he goes, bewildered, betrayed.
That. He's like, is that right? He's like, I honestly don't know. Sure. Like, all of it. But yeah, no, the movie as a whole, good story. It It doesn't at one. There's no point there where you're just like, oh shit, is this over yet? And also, fucking Hank Azaria, like, is
Azaria. Extremely underrated.
God, man.
Scuba. Sorry, when I go along came Polly. Scuba. You never watched that one? He was a scuba instructor.
I hate Ben Stiller.
Scuba.
He has some gems, though.
Yeah.
He's a better director than he's actor.
Facts, but he does have some solid gems. I'll give him some credit.
That was your favorite scene. What's your score?
And probably, yeah, a good 8. Definitely 8. Yeah, all right. 8 for sure. I also will say, too, the scene and the soup scene. Dude, you forgot the shrimp! Fuck the shrimp, bro! Like, that whole... God. Oh, my God.
So, to me... all right, so, no, it's going over to me now, right?
Yeah.
I said it already before, but, like, fucking... This was Nathan Lane's fucking Citizen Kane, if you will.
He needed more roles, though.
Yeah, no, but this was Nathan Lane's Citizen Kane. It is a goddamn injustice that this movie never got recognized. Because what did Greater Joe say?
Hank Azaria's character was a parody of Antonio Banderas' AIDS riddle.
Yes,
character.
He was.
Philadelphia.
Yeah.
Son of a bitch.
But, no, to me, because you know what this movie did, dude? Even in the 90s and now, it challenges you to, like, look past that shit, dude. You know, like, now, granted, I would never fucking, like, shout out to Val because he married a conservative woman, but, nah, I wouldn't stick my dick in anything like that now, dude. Like, but the thing is that, like, somehow these two families decided to come together, you know? And the thing is now, especially with what you know, it's funny, but you still sympathize or empathize with Albert's character. Yeah. As dramatic as he may be, like, guess what? He was always part of Val's life. And the thing is that, like, when he's like, oh, well, what, you didn't tell him? Like, when they have to, like, kick him out or whatever, he's right. Like, well, you didn't tell him? And you feel that pain, dude, because honestly, yeah. Like, look, I have gay friends, I have lesbian friends, I have lesbian friends that have a home. Not a house, a home. They have children. They have a home. I have trans friends. And I guess that's the beautiful thing about, like, when movies like that, because I watched that at a very young age. And I watched it again and I was like, holy shit, this still slaps.
Yeah.
But the thing is that movies like that challenged my convictions, dude, that, like, people are people and they still have homes and they are still humans and they still have emotions. And that's the beauty of that movie.
And I think that did that for a lot of people, too, back then.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, now, even now, dude, like, you can watch that movie, and it could still challenge. As progressive as we have come now...
Oh, yeah. People can still benefit from it.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, yes. And the thing is that, to me, it's a beautiful movie, because of that. Because this was one of the first movies where, like, and we talked about this, where, like, the gay characters weren't just some flamboyant comic relief. Like, it actually showed depth. It actually showed that, hey, because believe it or not, I actually knew a gay couple that the guy said one of the guys had a son. And it was almost like a birdcage situation. And believe it or not, when I stepped into those gay dudes' homes or into that gay partner's home, it wasn't a house, it was a home, dude. And it was a home because there was warmth. There was love. What is fucking Greater Joe saying?
It says, your name. Gay people are funny just like us.
Oh, my God.
Can we get that on a shirt?
That's hilarious. Yes. Just like us.
And then have Bodega Pirate right after. Yeah, no. I mean, I 100% agree. As we joke, I mean, it's truth. Like, certain people could see this and probably appreciate it a little bit more.
But again, like, you know, and this was back when I was like 17, but once I set into this gay couple's home, dude, I came from a broken home and I was like, wow. Like, I never felt this shit at a white Christian lady's home. I was like, the warmth, the welcoming, the love that, like, these folks have for one another and for anybody else.
It's true, though, because it makes you look at a person from a deeper perspective and not so shallow, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Like, and, dude, don't get me wrong. They were a little flamboyant. It was an Irish dude and a Honduran dude, and they were a little flamboyant,
that's an
dude.
Interesting mix.
But no, dude, but I loved them both, dude. They were like almost like my tangent parents, if you will, you know? Because every time I'd get drunk and I'd get emotional and everything, they'd be like, they would come. I didn't ask them to do it. They would come and cheer me up for me, dude. Shout out to them for that, dude.
Like, shout out to the Joe for gay people throw the best parties. I don't give a fuck.
Yes, they do. Yes, they do. Hey, I will fuck with you on that one.
The opening of the movie is any indication. And the ending. How they got the family out without being seen by the press.
So that
shout out to Gene Hackman.
Yes.
Because for going in drag. Even me, I was like, is that Gene Hackman? Like, I was still trying to figure out, like, that
but
is
that being
him.
Said, so there was a lot of time before when I watched the movie back in the 90s and, like, watching this now and then rewatching it again, dude, and feeling, a little sensitive about it, dude, because these are people. These are family. These are people that have homes, you know? And the thing is that, like, nowadays, like, the fuck I would turn my back on a fucking trans friend or a gay friend or anything like that. But back then it was like, oh, well, that's just what had to be done, you know? That being said, the movie was great. Fucking Nathan Lane hammed it up. This was a role that he was born to play and shit.
Nailed it.
Yeah, so to me, aside from the fucking restaurant scene, because that was fucking great. It was also when he was crushing on, when Gene Hackman was crushing on
the dinner, bro?
But then my third, because those are one and two, and then my third one was when fucking Gene Hackman is in drag and he tells his driver, meet me out back in 20 minutes. He's like, yeah, the fuck I will.
Not for $1 million fucking dollars. Yes. Bro.
But again, dude, this movie, it challenged and it took down a lot of, like, the convictions or the prejudices that we had towards gay people. You know, that they could be human. They could care for one another and everything. Mm. They weren't just flamboyant little fucking flamingos or whatever, if you will, you know?
Right.
So... True. So shout out to them. That was my favorite scene. My rating is going to be a fucking 9.75, dude.
Nice. All right. Well, we got one more. It's pretty much going to be me. We're not going to spend too much time on it. But I will say solid pick.
You want me to do the synopsis en español?
Sure. Fuck it. Go for it. Fuck it. Yeah, by all means. So the last review of the evening is Siege on J.ville. Or can potentially be pronounced as Jadotville as well.
Yeah.
Which I was kind of curious because I was like, is this a, like, but when I, after I saw, I was like, oh, it could be both.
Yeah. Let me know when you're ready.
I will say, he's going to do this in Spanish, but I'm going to let y'all know real quick. This is a true story.
Yes, it is. Año 1961 en el Congo, Jadotville. Cuenta la verdadera historia del comandante Patrick Quinlan y su batallón de 150 soldados irlandeses de la ONU, sitiados por 3,000 soldados congoleños bajo el mando de mercenarios franceses y belgas que trabajan para las empresas minaneras.
Nice. All right, and give us a quick English synopsis.
All right, so basically it's about 150 rowdy ass fucking Irish soldiers that fucking held it down in this one tiny position. Not one of them died.
Nope.
They surrendered until their ammo ran out.
Yup.
That's how fucking rowdy they were.
Yup.
Boatings.
The worst part about it, though.
I'll lead off with you. Let me drop it down, man.
No. I honestly enjoyed the film. Mm-hmm. What fucking hurt the most and pissed me off
was that they never got recognized.
Until 2005.
They were branded as cowards.
40 fucking years!
They were branded as cowards. Yes, dude.
40 years!
Yes, dude.
They called him J.ville Jacks.
Yes.
Yo.
Tragedy, dude. Tragedy,
dude. Like, because the thing is, what an... As anybody who's watched the show knows, I do enjoy a good true story. I do. I'm a fan. I love it. I love the human nature. I love how the brain works. I should have probably been a psychologist. But.
You still can, man. You still can.
I could. But I like this better. So that sold me right there. And then we all know, well, some of us know, if nobody knew for a while, I got a little bit of Irish in me. Fake Irish. And so that sold me,
Knock
too.
Sir
Patrick. Sir Patrick.
It's me manager, Patty.
Me manager, Patrick, here. I tell you what there. But no, honestly, it caught me on that. So those two factors right there. I was like, cool. Irish motherfuckers, cool shit. It's a true story. Cool as fuck. Wow.
Dude, the way that they took down the fucking helicopter. Dude.
That, honestly, since we're not going to spend too much time on this, that right there is a tie for favorite scene.
What was your other one?
That and the bar.
When he tells him, he's like, oh, well, we didn't surrender to the Nazis. Yes! Talk to me, brother!
Dude!
Talk to me!
How he handled that whole scenario, bro. Like,
yeah.
Because, so, all right, the siege on J.ville, you can't really spoil history because it's a factual story. This has happened, okay? You don't know this because you haven't watched it. The siege on J.ville is a true story. It's a true story about 150 Irishmen sent because the UN was trying to help defuse the situation in Congo back in 1961.
Yes, and okay. Then these mercenaries, these mining mercenaries, try to overrun them, and these 150 Irishmen
hold it the fuck down.
Held it the fuck down until they ran out of ammo.
Like,
they didn't surrender because they were overwhelmed or anything like that. They literally ran out of ammo, and that's when they surrendered.
And that is also the tie. How they ended the fight, basically. Mm. Brilliant! So, their commander, basically, he's a book smart commander. None of these guys have seen war. They're all war virgins, right? 150 of these guys, all war virgins. But their commander is a smart guy. He knows all the big battles. He reads on this shit, so he knows tactics like a smart man. And proves it throughout the 5-day siege.
Mortars, dude. The mortars, when they fucked everything.
They took all the little leftover shells and all that shit and rigged up explosives, used that as shrapnel. Like, just. And then.
A genius commander, dude.
The dopest scene, though, is when the helicopter shows up. So there's their helicopter.
Yeah, there's a gunship that's trying to like take him out. And
so
everything.
Shout out to homeboy. What's his name? The Dr. Quinn guy, the actor.
Oh my god,
He's Quinn. Alfred something, right?
Yes, I think so. Oh my god, I'm blanking out right now.
He was Archer in Archie in fucking Rock and Roller. Fucking Archie, Rock and Roller.
Mark Strong.
Yes. There it is, Mark Strong. Yes, he is a great actor. He was also Sinestro in the Green Lantern movie. Which they couldn't have got it better. He looked just like him.
Yeah.
But I digress. He was playing Dr. Quinn, which was one of the UN representatives.
Yes, he was. Okay.
For Ireland, right?
Yes. For Ireland, yeah. He was the Irish ambassador.
Yes.
Which he plays a fucking prick. He's like...
Yeah, I hated him.
Yeah, yeah, no, dude. Like, that whole, like, the political side of it, yeah. That can all eat a dick, dude.
When I tell you, like, because I don't mind history. I don't mind it at all. And when I get to see these little aspects of it, it really opens your eyes because it's like, it's not just over here.
Yeah.
It's over there, too.
Yep.
There are pricks over there, too. Because they basically sent in this battalion of guys, platoon of men, to hold down this place for 5 days and were met with resistance along the way every time. We need ammo. Well, we'll try. We'll try to get you some ammo. Then the reinforcements they try to get him get stopped by the mercenaries. So like, well, they have to turn back. Sorry about your luck, guys.
Yeah.
So it gets to a point where the helicopter's coming in with ammo and supplies, and there's a plane after it. These guys tip over a jeep with a mounted turret and use the turret to shoot the plane.
Yes,
that's
dude.
Awesome.
Yes, dude. They're like, they flip the bitch over. They're like, dude, that's the whole thing. Like, when it comes to anti-air combat, you basically need trajectories, telemetry, and everything, dude. For you to fucking just naked eye with a fucking 50 cal try to lead a fucking combat or a fucking fighter jet and take that bitch down when it was trying to, like, when this other craft is trying to, like, yes. refuel you or, like, fucking resupply you, dude, the balls, dude. I was like, Dude, when I watched that the first time, I was like, yeah!
Bro, I
fuck these dudes up.
Dude, I was like, when he said flip the Jeep, I was like, no, he's not.
Yes,
no,
he is.
No, he's not.
Yes, he is.
Holy
dude.
Shit, they are. And the thing is.
Hold that. Hold that.
I'm sitting here like, and as I'm watching this, I'm like in the back of my mind.
This is a true story.
Like, and this happened. Shit happened, bro. Like, it this happened, is the part bro. That blew my mind. I'm like, yeah, this makes sense. And it's crazy because you're like, yo, their own government was hanging them out to dry.
Yep.
To the very last minute, to where these boys surrendered only because, like he said, they ran out of ammo. Bullets. That's they the only reason bullets. They
That's
stopped.
Insane.
And they ended up being prisoners of war for a fucking month before they finally made agreements to be like, all right. And this is because they were trying to stop. It was Congo and Kanaga.
Yeah, it was basically it was the colonizers, the mercenaries for a mining company that were trying to like fight over these rights.
Right. And basically the leader of Congo at the time, they assassinated the previous leader, mm-hmm. basically. And it was all political. And these guys went in to do their job and got fucked. And basically, when they come home...
they fucked everybody else. They got fucked after they got home.
Bro, I'm telling you, watch it for yourself, just because it's a good film.
Yeah.
But it's crazy, because...
Boating, so what's your rating on this one?
Hold on. The thing is...
He's impassionate.
Because it sat really fucked up with me at the end, because the first thing this captain does when he gets off the plane back home... Not even that! He goes up to the general and he's like, all these men, 150, deserve medals. They're all war virgins and they all acted admirably.
And he didn't lose a one goddamn one of them.
He got injuries. That's it.
They got injured, but he didn't lose a man. He didn't
lose
a fucking man.
Single fucking solitary man. And you know what they said? Sorry about your luck, buddy. Because these assholes botched a mission prior to the siege or during the first.
Yeah, they
siege.
Killed. They killed the. Innocent. They bombed the. They bombed the radio station or something like that, yeah.
Their comms tower. They basically were trying to keep a foothold and keep the mercenaries out. And the Mark Strong's character was like, just do what you need to do. Show decisive action. So he was decisive, the guy he put in charge, but he killed 30 innocent people.
Oh, good.
Yeah. So this done pissed off the mercenaries even more.
You said this was based off a true story?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Okay. So this shit, because they even showed the interview, well, not interview, but the news newsreel from Kennedy. Because the guy who pretty much was telling Mark Strong's character, like, I'm done with you, his plane got shot down and they all died.
Yes, they did.
So that, and Kennedy was talking about that. So I was like, yo, this is crazy. Like, this shit happened.
It happened. It happened.
Like, and they only lost because they surrendered because they ran out of ammo. And when they went home, they were like, we're going to bury this under the carpet because
it's bad. It's a bad look.
It's a bad look for us. We don't want to be known as surrenderers.
And then.
So, you know, he knocked this motherfucker out. He knocked his general out.
Yes, dude.
And in general, I'll give him credit at this only one moment because he's like, I kind of deserve that.
He didn't. Yeah, he didn't throw the guy in jail who's like, I could have you court-martialed for this.
I was going to say, you could have court-martialed.
Yeah, he's like, but, you know, I kind of brought that upon myself. So, cool. So, for 40 years, these guys were known as cowards.
The cowards, yeah.
And it wasn't just till 2005 where it was officially, they were all
recognized,
pretty much awarded.
Yeah.
And then the movie was like, this is a dedication to y'all. Because
y'all clap some fucking hammers,
bro. The tactics behind it, like the moment they get there, because it's a pretty desolate little area. It's like a little small, little tiny ass little baby gas station type town. It's not even like a town. It's a little small settlement. And the moment they get there, he's like, dig trenches here, here, here.
Dude,
and
this guy was a tactician. But he knew.
And he showed why. And that's the thing is the he has a conversation with his wife before he leaves, and she's just like, you know, you enjoy going out there showing these motherfuckers that you can do what you say you can do, and basically prove it. And it's an amazing story about the prevalence of men and men in arms
and knowledge
because they 150 took out fucking
more than 3,000.
They took out definitely double their own men easily. Yeah. Easily in the sniper.
And a fucking jet.
The sniper,
yes,
bro.
And a fucking jet. And a fucking
when
jet.
When they shot that, okay, actually there's a tie. Now that I think about it, when they shot homeboy in the white suit.
Oh, yes.
Bro.
The general, yeah.
He's
it was
like, you see the guy in the white?
The general, he's like, take that motherfucker out. Bet.
He's like, you got a good shot at him? He's like, hold on. All right, I'm good. He's like, take the shot. Bah! Shit, it's tight. It's tight.
What was your rating, Bodings?
Rating, honestly, in respect to the men, it's a fucking 10.
All right.
In respect to the men. As a movie, it's a 9.
I'll take it. I'll take it.
But all as a whole, it's a 10.
I'll take it.
These men.
All right, so to me, great fucking movie. And, dude, it just randomly showed up one time on Netflix. It's like, oh, recommended for you. I was like, all right, fuck it. I got nothing else to do. Let's watch it. Dude, and just so to me, because I'm a bit of a military nerd, the tactical knowledge that this guy displays and everything. And I was like, yes, yes, clap these motherfuckers. Bro. Let's go.
So smart, bro.
Definitely. So my favorite scenes, there's too many of them, but there's two ties. All right. The one where he tells the French dude, he's like, yeah, well, we didn't fight in the war, but at least we didn't surrender to the Nazis. And he has a sip of French brandy. And he's like,
cognac.
And he goes, all right, bro, we gonna clap? All right, bet. But at least we didn't surrender to the Nazis. Let's fucking go.
That low-key blow, bro.
And then him fucking duffing out that general at the end. He's like, all of our men deserve a fucking recognition and everything. And they're not going to jail again because they will not be branded as cowards. Oh, they will be branded as cowards. Oh, word? Bet. Duff. Let's go. Definitely a 10 for me, dude. And chuckles if you can. Watch it, dude. I just want your retrospective opinion.
Honestly, when I was watching it, it to me kind of reminded me of like Saving Private Ryan.
Or even like the 300 because, I mean, 150.
But
you could call this
a real story.
150. Right. You could call this 150.
Like this shit you can look up. Like that's the crazy part about it. Like the whole time. I'm like,
it all happened. It is,
and
it is
his commander in arms, the other guy that was with him, the brolic motherfucker.
Yeah,
he was in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. He played Coulson's takeover guy. He was the soup, the fake soup, basically. Like he, bro, like it
he
just
was
shows
all over the place, dude. He was running all over,
and
the
like
place.
He did not. There was not one single moment where he was like, "You sure?" Like he just went like that. The trust they had in this man and just everybody, I loved it, man. It was a great movie. I recommend it. If you haven't seen it, go check it out. It's on Netflix. We're going to pick our flicks and get the fuck out of here.
All right.
So we're going to do the first, the reboot of Animaniacs.
All right. Can we also throw in there, because it's leaving Netflix and we haven't reviewed it yet, this will be my fucking pick if you'll have it. Let's do Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. Ooh. It's leaving Netflix next week, so we can review that.
Should I gotta watch that then?
We could. That's a maybe. The other night. That's a maybe. So I'm definitely picking a movie that is unconventionally Christmas.
Oh, that's right. We're doing unconventional Christmas. God damn it. Never mind. All right, so I'll switch over to Deadpool then.
All right, Deadpool?
Deadpool.
All right, we'll do Deadpool. And you know what? Fuck it. Die Hard.
Die Hard?
We'll do Die Hard. First Chuckles. Die Hard.
You got anything, or?
Well, we're just doing the first Animaniacs, and then
Die Hard and Deadpool.
Right.
All
right. So that works. That. Yeah. So if y'all want to join in the conversation and fuck off and have
do
fun,
so.
Deadpool, the original first Deadpool movie, not the second one, the first one, and then Animaniacs, the reboot, the first season, the
and
only
Die
season,
Hard.
And Die Hard. So.
And I got a song for y'all on the fucking, on the page. What's up?
The Joe says, Wikipedia said they had 500 soldiers supporting the 158. That was probably the reinforcements
that
showed
never
up.
Showed up. Yeah, that never showed up.
But yeah, so I want to thank y'all for tuning in. Bodega Pirating, last words.
As always, stay hydrated so we don't thirst for these hoes. Wear a fucking mask. Fuck GameStop. Fuck you Black Friday motherfuckers. Y'all feed into this bullshit.
Tell them.
Yeah, goddamn right. And let's go Giants.
All right. Chuck.
Fuck masks. I didn't wear mine going into the gas station earlier because I hate those fucking
things. Oh, you.
Wow. Fucking hate them.
Gosh darn it.
Gosh darn you, Chuck.
Fucking hate those things, dude. So gay.
It is what it is.
Name of your sex tape.
Are you mad?
I hate these things.
The
it's
joke
so
earlier?
Gay.
Oh my god.
That's perfect. I hate these things. It's so gay.
Volume 1.
Yes. Oh my god. That's
Bodings, what do you got to say to
him? Well, are you good?
Yeah, I'm
that's
good.
That's it. All right. Honestly, I'm good. Thank y'all for tuning in. The FooL and Friends Facebook page, go like it, follow it, please.
I'll throw a Die Hard video on there.
And yeah, we're gonna check those out, and obviously all the news and shit in between now and then. But y'all stay safe out there.
Thank y'all.
Tune into all the rest of the shows on the FooL How Radio Network. Give us some love. And
gang,
FooL,
gang.
Capital L. I want to thank y'all for tuning in. I love y'all. Peace.